36 cars lined up on the grid for round three of the Australian Endurance Championship for 1985. This, the Castrol 500 at Sandown in Melbourne. 129 laps, 503.1 kilometres to be accurate on the very tight 3.9 kilometre track. And that's a very hard one indeed for drivers, as you know, Alan Moffat.
It is extremely difficult. Well, Sandown used to be considerably easier, demanding as a driver mentally, the fear of making a mistake on a high-speed track. But with the extension to the new track, it has become much harder for the drivers.
They get away with Peter Brock making a good start and running side by side with him. Dick Johnson, in fact, forging to the lead. Peter Brock and Grice just behind him, but it should be Johnson. First into the first corner, he sweeps across the bows of the field. And popular Johnson from Queensland goes into the lead with Brock third only. Squeezing down the inside of him, or trying to, is Richards in the black BMW, but he's back in fourth. It's the Volvo Francevic fifth. And then it's the other Mobil Holden dealer team car sixth. That's John Harvey Parsons. Then it's Denny Holm, the 1967 world driving champion in the gold car seventh. And look at Johnson just streaming away from the field. There's his lead as they go up the back straight at Sandown. A shorter straight now. And Johnson's now hard on the brakes. The field closes on him in distance, but not time. You can see the black BMW in the apex of the corner there. And some fairly rude driving from some of the others, as Peter Williamson, I think, was at it again in the orange Toyota Supra, ducking underneath the car as they came down to the inside of the corner. But it's Dick Johnson, the man who at 6:30 last night discovered that 20 wheels that had cost him $10,000, all brand new, were all cracked. He has borrowed four wheels for the front from Allan Grice, as he locks one of the fronts there, and has some of his own spare wheels for the rears. But that's a fairly calamitous discovery for Dick Johnson at this stage. Francevic wide, and then followed by John Harvey. The second black BMW has Neville Crichton.
It's been a long time, Will, since a Ford's been this far out in front on an opening lap of any racing that we've seen. He's trying extremely hard there, wanting to get a good time onto the straight so that he can open up the power of that V8 engine.
Listen to the crowd as he comes down the main straight, coming back from the pits. The roar was unbelievable when Johnson shot away, and listen to it now. And he's got a lead of about 200 metres on Peter Brock.
Not only 200 metres, but it's 2.27 seconds, which is quite remarkable.
That's the thing that people sitting at home may not appreciate. Well, a tenth of a second we would sell our grandmothers for. He's got a considerable lead, and he's doing the old Peter Brock trick, trying to get out and demoralizing the field on the opening laps while his tires are in great shape. You can see him using up every ounce of real estate there. He's not concerned about whether he's on or off the track, simply because he wants to keep the flow of the car pointed and get every ounce of horsepower he's got pointing through those rear tires.
So he's obviously got confidence in his replacement wheels to be doing that in the opening laps. Will the tyres, though, stay in great shape if he continues?
Well, every driver is the only one that can control his tyres, Peter, and he is working them hard at the moment, but I think he's very, very determined to get a lead on Peter and let him know that he wants to control this race.
He, in fact, did that at Oran Park. He worked his car very hard.
Let's see what it looks like. Trackside, Jim Keogh's BMW. That's a view from about midfield of the 85 Castrol 500.
Keogh is sharing with Gary Rogers. Rogers is in the car at the moment, the man who is pretty usually in the top 10 qualifiers at Bathurst. They had problems with the car on Friday and so didn't qualify yesterday. So they were allocated 20th. When I say didn't qualify, they didn't have time to set a practice time, allocated 20th grid position.
Will, the circuit has been widened and lengthened here at Sandown as we look at it from the Jim Keogh, Gary Rogers car, but it's obviously not wide enough for some of our leading drivers.
Yes, well, every extra centimetres they can pinch is worth grabbing.
A half a centimetre will do. We're not fussy.
And Dick Johnson completes his second lap and goes for a lead of 2.85 seconds. Now over Brock, from Grice, from Richards. And those three in second, third and fourth place are in fairly close company, as you can see. You see them looming there. And then there's Francevic fifth, And he's established a bit of a gap back to Harvey, who's now sixth in the second mobile holder dealer team car. But you can see Brock, Grice, and particularly Richards, very close company indeed. Is Richards in the BMW, I think, Allan, starting to feel as though he'd like to work forward just a touch?
Yes, and I think probably we'll have a little bit of difficulty getting by Allan Grice, because with the power of a V8, any time in a straight line, a V8 is the nicest thing to have under the bonnet. And he'll find it a little bit of difficulty getting alongside Jim and getting by that Commodore, that Kmart Commodore.
Gary Wilmington in the Jaguar there with the camera car is that beautiful burgundy-coloured BMW in the group there. So you've got a view of Gary Wilmington's Jaguar up in front, being followed and harried, in fact, by Gerald K. Martin Power in their Commodore number 24.
And also, Will, a view of how the weather conditions are here at Sandown. Very dark, some light misty rain when they got away. Doesn't affect this man, though.
A 53.86, the second lap for Dick Johnson, considering that qualifying was only 52.3, Allan Moffat. That's a remarkable time on full tanks.
It certainly is, Will, and he's showing a commanding lead here for the opening number of laps. If he can compound this advantage each lap, picking up a quarter of a second or a half a second, I don't think he'd be that much. He's going to certainly be giving Peter Brock something to think about.
Obviously, the full tanks, Allan, in these opening laps not affecting them.
Oh, yes, it is affecting them. They know they've got them there, and they would feel it under brakes, Peter, coming down the end of the straight. They'd have to make sure they didn't miss their brake marker by more than a couple of inches. Otherwise, they'd find themselves in a great deal of difficulty when he makes that turn right there. But these Group A cars are handling very nicely. I'm surprised for the decreased width of the tires, which normally is the controlling factor. They're holding their own very well. Dick's sliding the car a bit more than I'd like to see at this stage of the race, but he obviously knows what he's doing.
Well, that 2.27 second lead on the first lap has been considerably whittled in the sense of what he's gained on each of the next two laps. Went to 2.8 on the second, and it's now just 3.04, which says that Peter Brock, in fact, is starting to try and go with Dick Johnson, although Johnson has done another 53 second lap, 53.8. And here he is, this tight section corner off the main straight up the back, or one of the two straights, and it's a descending corner.
Oh, he's doing that very nicely, Will. He's using every ounce of the road and working the car, saving the tires. The drivers at this stage are desperate to save their tires. They know they want to try and get to their designated pit stop lap, and ideally halfway, which I think is too far to try and expect a set of tires to go in these days. But nevertheless, every time you see a little slide on that beautiful Mustang, it's a little bit of rubbers going west.
Mustang that, in terms of the generation of Mustangs with which you were very familiar.
I've got a soft spot for Mustangs.
I bet you have. Well, in fact, do you still own the Trans Am?
I certainly do, and it's in my workshop. I see it every day.
Doesn't look much like that one, though, Allan.
No, but mine was always Coca-Cola red, so the color-wise, you can't tell.
But it was also had lots of very expensive parts in it, didn't it? The radiators and all sorts of things. Oh, yes, very sophisticated
car. First of the aluminum radiators, yes. It was quite a car in a state, Will. It transformed Australian motor racing in 1969, and I think we're looking at a new transformation here this year with the advent of the Group A cars.
And I think Brock a little closer to Johnson this time.
2.8 seconds, so he's come back from 3.04 to 2.8. The other point, Allan, in these front-running cars is that we've got Johnson on Avon's in the leading car, Brock on Pirelli's in the second-place car, Grice on Yokohama's in the third, and then Richards on Pirelli in the BMW.
Well, I think one of the things that may be contributing to Dick's pleasant lead at the moment is the compounding in the Avon tires. They're an English tire. They've traditionally been the softest of the tire manufacturers. By that, I mean they are prepared to make a softer type of compound. And anytime you have a softish tire, then you can get advantage. Now, Dick's problem will be not to wear that softness out too much. And what we may be seeing is Peter Brock's tires settling into the groove a little bit more readily.
Incidentally, we've seen the BMW, I can see around the back section of the circuit, has got past Allan Grice now. But the other thing that's happening with Johnson up front is that lap time, the last lap, was 54.54. So he dropped nearly, say, 7/10 of a second. He's running into traffic now and leading the field through, and that's why Brock has pulled back that couple of tenths of a second on him.
Certainly, and that's what he's got ahead of him for the rest of the day. Well, they've got to be able to get through traffic economically as quickly as possible, as nothing more frustrating for a lead driver to have a commanding 3 or 4 seconds swallowed up by a back marker and then see your opposition on your bumper bar.
Well, the head of the field really bunching up now as Johnson comes back a touch to Brock, so does Brock come back a touch to Richards, and Grice perhaps just losing a little contact with Jim Richards.
Well, Allan Grice is on the Yokohama brand tire, and perhaps of the three brands could be the hardest. Grice could be looking to go to the halfway distance, and traditionally a foxy driver and prepared to sit back and let the others run their race up at the front. He's got a game plan and no doubt is attempting to stick to it.
Except when he's somewhere near
Dick
you, Allan.
Won't want to be doing too much more of that. Now, Peter certainly won't want to be doing a lot more of that.
Yes, he's driving it very hard there.
This looks like it's going to be a very short 500-kilometer Castrol race, Will. I can't see them driving like this for too much longer.
Dick Johnson, a 53.88 that last lap, which took the lead back out to 3.07 seconds. So it's Johnson that's varying rather than Brock. And the other point is that it's now 4.24 seconds back to that man in the black car, Jim Richards, the 1985 Australian Touring Car Champion.
Some lights there, warning to back markers from Dick Johnson.
That's Don Smith's new Toyota Sprinter.
124 laps to go in this 129 lap race, and that's our third place man. Jim Richards won the two opening rounds of the championship, Australian Touring Car Champion, and perhaps the BMW brought back a touch to the field with the new regulations.
Well, yes and no. You'll pardon me for being political. No. Is this a non-political broadcast? Yeah. As it will. Dick Johnson has had to swallow a number of placings all year long because he didn't have the parts homologated. As I understand it, the parts were put through to Paris, and the right T's and the right wrong I's were in place, and Ford Dearborn didn't get the parts through the homologation system, which Dick is now running. And, you know, good on him to be out in front and savoring a little bit of glory here in front of Ford country with the Ford executives in the grandstand, I'm sure.
So six laps down, and it's Dick Johnson leading Peter Brock in the 85 Castrol 500.
Have that constraint this year?
No, mate. If we could use low, we would, with these gearboxes are that strong. And really, we don't expect any trouble.
How does the track suit you as a driver?
Well, I don't mind the track at all. There's a lot of very slow corners. And the only problem you have is the fact that when you come up against a very slow car, sometimes it's very difficult to get around him, and you can lose a couple of seconds a lap.
This is the first of the true long-distance races. How will the Mustang perform in the closing stage?
I think that's something we'll just have to wait and see, because we're going to wring its neck tomorrow and just see what happens.
Allan, is he wringing its neck?
He's certainly doing a pretty good job of it, Peter. He is driving very forcefully, although I see he's in his normal laid-back, relaxed driving fashion. Dick always looks very relaxed behind the wheel. The car appears to be very nicely balanced. He's hounding it where he has to. The camera angle doesn't show the apexes that he has to try and pick up, particularly where they're dropping that right rear wheel onto the main straight. He's just trying to get every ounce of horsepower going for him in a straight line so that he can capitalize on 5,000 cc's of engine up that main straight. That's where he's getting his dividends, and that's where he wants to collect them.
He's certainly capitalizing, because he's in the last two laps, the one just completed and the one previous to that, Dick Johnson has taken a lead from 3.07 seconds to 4.04 and to 4.47, and Richards trails in third place by an additional 4.37 seconds.
Well, Peter, who loves to race and races so well from the lead, of course most drivers do, but there are responsibilities when you're out in front staying there, will definitely be saying to himself, golly, is Dick going to blow up? Can he possibly last this pace? And would be saying to himself, well, I can't catch him. I certainly can't catch him. I better just be happy to stay where I am.
So Johnson really building nicely. Here in third place is Jim Richards. As I said, 4.37 seconds behind second-placed Peter Brock, who's been dropping time and is nearly now 4.5 seconds behind Johnson. But behind Richards is now Robbie Francevic in the Volvo Turbo. He's in fact taken Allan Grice. But look at the way Richards is conserving the car around there, although looking at him earlier, he was in fact clambering on a lot of curbs. But what this aerial shot is really showing is just how tight that back section of the circuit is.
It certainly is.
Oh, wheel work everywhere.
He wants to conserve those tires as much as possible. And he's not quite, he's driving with verve, but he isn't hammering it as hard as we see Dick Johnson.
Third place man is Jim Richards. 121 laps to go, a 129 race.
Well, Johnson's moving away to an even greater lead, 5.02 seconds now, but the interesting thing is that Richards was hanging on to the same gap from Brock. So Brock and Richards, and now Francevic there in fourth place, are fairly consistent. It's Johnson who's got the pace on all of them at the moment and continuing to build his lead. Then in fifth place you see Allan Grice.
Well, with respect, Will.
And Richards? BMW pulled up. That's surely the second car of Crichton that he's sharing with George Feary, who was opening in that car, going very slowly up the back straight. Now that's been lapped by the leading bunch, which means he's down a lap. I'd say he's got no engine power. And almost stopping, will stop, up the back straight.
Been the Richards BMW, will it? It is car one, Jim Richards, and a sigh of exasperation from Alan Moffat. Because you're sorry for Jim, or because
I know that feeling. This is a situation where a team does everything humanly possible. Frank Gardner, a great management team behind this whole BMW operation, and on the opening, less than 10 laps into the race, Jim will just, well, he'll know he's had it. He's finished for the day. He may be able to get it back to the pits and rectify a situation. Probably a silly fuel blockage or something of that nature. It's obviously, looks like he's gone to his door to get his toolkit out. Jim's a good mechanic himself. He knows the ABCs from one end of that car, and if it's possible to be fixed, he'll get it back.
Will, it would appear to be something silly because we were following him for that lap and he looked so good.
Yes, indeed. It just lost power, obviously, or drive, because he was crawling up the back straight. It was just going nowhere. It was just rolling. The interesting thing is that Francevic, who, of course, now moves forward a place, Richards is fairly optimistic that he's cured the problem, I'd say, by the way he's buttoning down the bonnet and clambering back in. Francevic, to me, sound as though the Volvo Turbo is misfiring a little. They did have a misfiring problem in that car yesterday. So we'll keep a close eye on it, but let's see if Richards can get underway in car one, proudly bearing the number because it's now the Australian Touring Car Championship car. And let's go down to the JPS BMW team with John Smales.
And the team manager is Frank Gardner. Frank, any idea at this stage what could be the problem?
Well, we're separated a few miles away. I'm not really sure. I have no idea, but we've got a car coming in, so we'll just have to pay a bit of attention.
Would you ride him off at this stage?
Well, yeah, it's a bit of a sprint race. You can't really afford to hang around too much.
Back live at the Castrol 500, and our leader, Dick Johnson, is in the pits. Dick Johnson, what's happened?
Well, it's just broken an axle. Simple as that.
Dick, you were leading, no, dominating the race for 22 laps. How hard were you pushing the car?
No, it was doing it very, very easy indeed. The car was running extremely well and we were just cruising.
Nonetheless, it looked as if you were doing a little bit of curb jumping, Dick. Could that have contributed to the axle?
No, well, it's a fully floating axle setup. All the axle does is drive the motor car. It's just the power of the Ford, I suppose.
Is there any chance now that you can get back into the race?
Yeah, we'll be back in there shortly. We'll just go out and do a bit of testing for Bathurst.
It must be very disappointing for you, Dick, to say the least.
Mate, I only want to win one race this year, and that's the next one.
So this is really a test for you?
I couldn't give a damn about this race. I want to win the next one.
Dick, what happened with the wheels we heard about this morning, that they were all cracked?
Yeah, we got some new wheels out, and they did about 10 laps, and the whole lot of them are cracked. So we had to borrow a couple of wheels and juggle things around and make spaces up and things like that, and borrowed some of Allan Grice, actually.
Well, Dick, 50% of our race crowd at the moment is crying at home because the hero's out of it. How hard is this event?
It's very, very tough on motor cars, especially transmissions. The engines these days aren't really a problem, but transmissions are really hard to push around here because there's so much gear changing and there's so many slow corners where you're in lower gears the whole time and you put an awful lot of strain on the axles and the tail shaft and stuff like that.
Well, Dick, a great disappointment. We certainly hope that the James Hardy 1000 holds better fortune for you.
Mate, I tell you what, it will have to be.
Dick Johnson. Well, that was the start of the problems in the pits. Next in was Peter Brock, and he had blown a rocker arm, and Brock also has stepped out of his motor car. He's put David Oxton into it, and Oxton is now out there, but about 20 horsepower down. We'll try to bring you an interview with Peter Brock shortly. I've just noticed John Harvey is now in the pits, and Harvey has been in the pits longer than is necessary for a normal change. We'll wander down there now to him.
What a race this has been. Incredibly changing fortunes. Dick Johnson leading for the first 22 laps. Peter Brock from lap 23 up to and including lap 25, pitting on lap 26. Francevic taking over the lead on lap 26. And we're now, he has completed lap 34. He's on his 35th. Just seen Kent Bajan, incidentally, go past Peter Brock. They're back in about sixth place at the moment. But there's our race leader, Robbie Francevic. His lead is 33.55 seconds over Allan Grice, is now second in car number six. And Grice's lead over third-placed George Fury in the other JPS BMW, 635, is just 9.2 seconds. Fury driving the car that Neville Crichton has been campaigning earlier on in the year. Now, we've seen John Harvey work his way up to second place with various problems with other competitors, with Johnson and Brock. And then when he was second, he blew up on lap 33, and he's now out of the race. There you see the race situation as it is. 35 completed, the leader only on his 36th lap. But there really have been an incredible number of incidents. Kent Bajant was at one stage in car number three, not Kent Bajan driving at the moment, it's Neal Lowe. He was up to fourth place on lap 20. He then pitted and fell to 10th place. Peter Brock, of course, pitted and fell back to 7th place. And that pair, Bajan and Brock, are now in 6th and 7th place and have just changed place. But let's go back down again to the pits and to John Smales.
In second place with lap 35 completed was John Harvey, and then disaster. What happened, John?
Well, I had the brake pedal going down a little bit for the last few laps, and I let the pits know to be prepared. I wasn't actually sure what was wrong with the master cylinder or wheel cylinder or something like that, and I'm really not sure at the moment. I've just got out of the car. David's got in ready to go. They're working on the car. And I guess I can say it's a bit of a shame, really, because the car was pretty well positioned. I was happy with everything else. It was just staying along quite nicely and felt like I could do it all day.
Well, everyone said that the Castrol 500 was going to be a real test for Bathurst, that this circuit really sorts out the cars. Is that the case?
Well, the Castrol 500 always is a unique race. And obviously today is no exception. Yeah, it's tough on cars and men. We've won it before, but I don't think we're looking too good today, somehow.
John Harvey, thank you.
In fact, John Harvey had a wretched time. Yesterday, he had to do... No, this morning, they did an engine change. Had a nice engine in the car, but they had a harmonic balancer problem yesterday as we again look at Francevic coming around, completing lap 36 and therefore in the lead for the past 10. Harvey's team decided that the timing chain had been stretched, changed the engine to an engine that Peter Brock took out on Friday. Brock said he just felt funny about it. Wasn't revving properly and didn't like it. And Harvey deduced, he said it felt nice this morning, deduced that it perhaps was the tachometer reading slightly inaccurately in Brock's car. But as we now know, Brock apparently sensed correctly and was out of the race because the engine didn't have much life left in front of it.
These lead drivers always get accused of having premonitions on Saturday night, Will.
But there is Allan Grice, who's now holding down second place. Grice had been forced back as far as fifth place on lap 20, and there we see the lead car, the man he's chasing, the man who is about 35 seconds in front of him. Let's watch him go through the S's, sweeping out of one of the tight back corners in the track in what is now a very, very tight racetrack indeed. All full throttle and then overrun, which is backloading the transmission around the back section of the circuit as they back off, usually doing it at very high revs, and it's very hard therefore on the transmissions. But as we heard Johnson say, most of the leading teams, be it a Mustang, a Volvo, a Holden Commodore or a BMW, all running German Gurtrag five-speed gearboxes, and they're pretty much made for the job. But you can see there, a lot of those corners are a lift off and then hard back onto the throttle, which really does snap the transmission very hard and make life difficult. But again, it's back down to the pits and to John Smales.
Nine times winner of the Castrol 500. Peter Brock, it doesn't look like it's going to happen this year.
Oh, I wouldn't write us off just yet. We're out there on the track. The car is going about a second lap slower than what we'd like it to be going because it's running on seven cylinders, but it's out there. That's the main thing.
Well, Peter, that was the same problem that happened at Amaru Park.
Yeah.
Is it a faulty batch of components?
No, I think it's just that we're trying to race an engine that isn't the engine we'd like to race. The engine we'd like to race is a current production engine, but the CAM's ruling wouldn't let us use that engine this year. We have to wait till next year. So just what we'll do, I'm not too sure. It's you can only inspect the componentry, you can, within the rules, you can heat treat it, rework it, but it's got to be the original piece. So we're going to do a little bit of homework between now and Bathurst, but I'm sure the boys will overcome it.
Well, in the race today, there's still 75% distance remaining for that car.
Yeah.
Surely other components might go out in sympathy?
I can't understand the logic of that one.
No?
No.
My question is, if you've got one component down, is it not putting more stress on the other than the engine?
Oh, not necessarily, no. The engine's just running slightly, roughly. It feels like driving the plug lead off, nothing more, nothing less. So I think all the damage that was done is done, and I don't expect anything more. In fact, you probably have a better tyre life now because you've got no horsepower to spin the back wheel.
When are you going to bring oxygen in and put yourself back in the car?
Well, wait till we get this car out of the way, which has got a brake problem, and then we can sit down. But I'd say at least another 20 or 30 laps.
That's Peter Brock. Don't ride him off. There's a long way to go in the Castrol 500.
Well, Will, I think what we may have been seeing there, Peter, was dying to say roller rockers, which, if you recall, about a decade ago was the syndrome, and that's exactly what's happening to those engines at the moment. They are having difficulties with their rockers. It's a high-stress area, not homologated. You can imagine making thousands and thousands of those. People in the grandstand would have a lot of use for them. But it was being mooted earlier at the speeds they wanted to go. That was going to be a problem.
Well, in fact, we were looking there, and we're looking now at Peter Fitzgerald in that Mitsubishi Starion Turbo number 43. He's actually now back in 11th place. He's come up one place just as he came past the start-finish line and is in 10th outright. But Fitzgerald, just at lap 35, was in fact 4th outright, lap 34, running extremely well. He qualified the car well, 6th grid position. a car that Allan Bartlett has been helping develop in recent times. Now has an intercooler and around 280 horsepower from the 2.3-litre turbo motor in the car. Similar capacity, similar way of boosting the power to the Volvo that's leading the race. But they got out of touring car racing in the middle section of the season after a very disappointing run at Bathurst last year. Really have taken no part this year, waiting for August 1 homologation and new freedoms, and have come back very strongly indeed in these Mitsubishi Starions. Peter Fitzgerald, of course, was king of Group E series production type racing in the Starion, was almost unbeatable against a really mixed bunch of cars in that class of racing. And now, as he said, we're in the big time. He's in the similar car to Kevin Bartlett. Bartlett qualified his two places behind on eighth grid position. They started immediately behind each other. And he, like a lot of people, has recently had a pit stop. And here we see one of the Ford Capris. Sorry, it's Laurie Nelson's Mustang, car number 28.
Sandown Beach there, down the bottom end of the main straight.
Yes, well, just as it's hard to get out of there, it's extremely effective in stopping a car when you get in.
He's going to need more than a rotary hoe to get it out of there, Will.
Yeah, well, Laurie Nelson ruining the effects of sand just the same as Allan Grice did at the end of the straight at Bathurst a few years ago.
Yes, we remember that one. The sand traps are doing their job, and that's what they're there for. You wouldn't want to be going off at the end of the main straight here at the speeds they're doing and not having something to stop them. And at least now with a push, the car's in one piece. His pride might be injured, but not his car. Just shows how effective that sand really is. And
gotta put some weight on the back wheels there as we watch our leader up the back of the course, just come up the back straight and into the loopy part of the circuit, the new area. That's Robbie Francevic in the Volvo. He's on his 40th lap. When will he come in for a pit stop? That's the question. I don't think the Mark Petch team even know. The fuel consumption for the Volvo, Allan. That's going to play?
Well, this is something that, again, we don't really know, and team managers don't really like to discuss. It's obviously working well for the Volvo team, and he's being quite conservative on the car for the first number of laps and is now gleaning the benefits of having a tidy, neat car that isn't in any way causing him any difficulty.
A number of interesting points with that car. The car owner, New Zealand businessman Mark Petch, was originally nominating himself to drive the car to join Francevic in it. He's a former New Zealand touring car champion but hasn't raced for some while. But in fact, they've put John Bauer, the Australian Formula One single-seater champion, in the car, and he's been practicing very well in it. The other point was that there was a threat at the end of the Oran Park race in the week immediately after, at a hearing in Spa in Belgium, that some of the allowances that had been given to the Volvo might have been taken away because they hadn't sold the requisite number of cars. That hearing has now gone through, and Volvo has totally satisfied FISA, the International Commission for Motorsport that controls motorsport, and they have been able to keep all their allowances. The previous motion has been totally rescinded. And Neal Lowe in car number 3, who had been up to fourth place, we'd seen him go past Allan Grice, and is even now at this stage was in fifth place, has pulled up on the grass, and he seems to seems to feel it's terminal, but he's exactly like Jim Richards. He feels he can do something about it.
And we saw Richards just before we saw the beige and low car go off. He's worked back up to 12th after being 28th after pulling off. I wonder if Neal Lowe has managed to talk to the JPS pits and find out what work Richards did under the bonnet.
Well, it's certainly good to see that all the BMW drivers are good lead mechanics as well. Obviously need to have a pair of pliers and a screwdriver handy for minor touch-ups under the bonnet. It certainly can get you back to the pits if nothing else.
Slightly built man, Lowe, born in January 1948 in New Zealand, and same age, in fact, as the man that owns the car, Kent Bagent, a businessman who one of his products that he manufactures and sells over there is Nilfisk vacuum cleaners. And the man that owns the car and has been campaigning it regularly throughout the season, and whom I watched race at Macau earlier last year is Kent Vagent. But we're looking at the man in car number six, Allan Grice. Grice at the moment in second place. He is just coming up to complete 41 laps, as the race leader has done in car number 55. That, of course, is Robbie Francevic. But I was saying Kent Vagent is the car owner of number three, will take the second stint, I suspect, in the car, and he's down in the pits with John Smales.
Well, Kent, this car's stuck out there in the middle of the track. Any idea what the problem might be?
Well, I don't know, mate, but I got news out of the vans. I mean, we came in before with a little problem, went out of 10th, we're back up to 5th, now going for 4th, and now he stopped again. I don't really know what's going on. We can see him across there running around the same as I was at Orange Park, but it's a little bit...
Next time you're going to drive the car first yourself?
Oh, no, Neil's done a brilliant job. You can't... Don't
I wasn't giving him a hard time. What I'm saying is it must be frustrating for you in here.
Oh, no, it's probably as good for me out here than it is for him in the car, you know. Plenty of adrenaline going here as well.
Well, you've got more than 80 laps left to go, so anything's possible.
It is, yeah. Anything's possible, but I just can't make out what the story is. I mean, we had the same problem and we thought we'd found the problem, but if it is the same thing that happened at Oran Park, then I don't know what it is. It's a little gremlin somewhere. I know that JBS had the same thing. They changed a lot of things in their car and they didn't find it, or presumably so. So I don't know what's happening.
Okay, thank you.
Kent Vagent, incidentally, is running third in the championship with a second and an eighth place in the two previous rounds. As we again pick up on Allan Grice.
This is a brand new car, Will, prepared by Allan Grice's longtime chief mechanic and crew chief, Les Small. Quite a brilliant job to bring it out first time up, put it on the front row of the grid, just missed pole by a tenth of a second. I think is extremely creditable. And Grice and Les are working on a reasonably small budget team.
He is indeed. And there's another brand new car that missed pole by a tenth of a second, because Dick Johnson's Mustang is not the car that we've seen throughout the year. It was a brand new one.
Grice getting harried there by Kevin Bartlett, who's come back into the race. He was the first man to pull out on lap 8. He's got going again, and he's giving Grice a bit of a push there. Bartlett, though, with Grice in second, Bartlett in 36th.
Be interesting to watch these two cars down the straight, because in fact what happens with the Mitsubishi Starion is that above about 6,000 revs it comes off boost. Boost goes back from about 1.5 to about 1 atmosphere. It almost loses all the boost. The turbo is a little bit small, as we see in the pits. Jim Keogh and Gary Rogers in the camera car. That's Keogh just going up to the side of the car. Car that started from 20th grid position. Beautifully presented, the former Group C car of the JPS BMW team, last year's race car for Jim Richards, converted and then bought from the previous owner, who used it for a short while earlier this year.
I don't think we're going to see any more pictures out of it. Race time, as Brock has blown a motor back straight.
Some of the crowd love it.
Well, and this is the car running on seven cylinders, Will, and as Peter said, it's not quite like running on seven. Having a plug lead come off, there's definite problems underneath that rocker cover, putting a bit of a strain on the rest of the timing.
That's train. 13th position, Peter Brock, who with you, Alan Moffat, the only one to have won this race in the last 12 years. So one thing that's going to happen today, and it's very hard to pick at the moment, but we're going to have a new race winner at Sandown for the first time in 13 years.
Well, that's pretty good in itself, really, isn't it? This is one of the things that was mooted that would be good about Group A, and as such is coming to the fore. One thing is certain about any race, it doesn't have to be here to have an exclusive franchise on the fact that if you can't finish, you're not going to win. And the pace that the lead teams are creating, the slightest difficulty that takes you off song takes you out of the race, and here we have an example of it. I also believe we have a situation where the teams are pushing as hard as they possibly can. They want a failure here. They want to be able to go back to the engineers and say, look, fix this before Bathurst. We've only got 3 weeks to get our act together.
David Oxton out of the car. Peter Brock not bothering to get back in it.
The camera car, incidentally, was up to 13th place, so Gary Rogers had done a good job in that car to work it forward. But that's where Brock was too. David Oxton, when the disaster occurred.
The Holden dealer team have maintained the lug nut situation for their wheels. They're one of the few teams that have. The fellows are very fast. You can try getting this kind of service at your local service station on a Saturday morning. But a lot of the teams have got the single wheel nut holding their wheel and tire combination on. They're much bulkier. If they strip a thread, they're in a heck of a lot of trouble. And personally, I go for this system myself.
So we can push them back around behind the pits.
Let's
they bother working on it. It looks like they are there.
Not too many times in the last decade, Will, we've seen 05 get pushed anywhere other than over the finish line.
Oh, indeed. It's been a great time for him. But the man who's reveling in Brock's problems and Dick Johnson's problems and Neal Lowe's and various other people is this one, Francevic, in 55. Isn't he loving it? Winner of two rounds of the Touring Car Championship this year. Peter Brock, the winner of the other one, seven of them being won by Jim Richards in the BMW. And the veteran New Zealand driver who we saw race in Australia 15 more years ago in, as we see, the other Mobil Holden dealer team car, also pulled up in the pits. That's the one that let out a similar cloud of smoke before Brock's 05 car did. But Francevic drove Formula 5000s at Warwick Farm and other places and is a very experienced driver indeed. Got into a contretemps at Calder with Peter Brock. Brock claiming that a touch with the Volvo tore a valve out of his wheel and gave him a flat tyre, and that was scoffed at by many people.
David Parsons in the number 7 car of the Mobil Holden dealer team. He's been there for a while. There's Robbie Francevic.
We're certainly not seeing any 30-second pit stops today, Will. And, that's going to have to be the speed at which everyone's going to want to be in condition for in 3 weeks' time.
Indeed, and as we look at the Volvo, it's interesting to talk about perhaps the European Touring Car Championship, of which today at Nogaro in France, the 11th round is being run. At the 10th round, just a week ago at Silverstone, pole was taken by a Mitsubishi Starion Turbo, Vern Schuppen.
Good night.
Co-driving the car, but it was won by Tom Walkinshaw and Wyn Percy, who of course are coming here to Bathurst in the Jaguar. They won it in a Rover, but the series is being led by Brancatelli and Lindstrom with 203 points in a Volvo Turbo.
Yes.
But of course they are now scratchings from Bathurst. They will not be coming. And
well, it's interesting that when you alluded to the International Tribunal, they're probably lucky they're not scratchings from the whole series.
That's our third place man we're watching, George Fury, a guest driver for the JPS team. He's sharing the car with Neville Crichton. And up to third place with the other JPS BMW of Jim Richards, up to seventh after being 28th.
Yes, indeed. Fury is a remarkably versatile driver. He's been sitting on his tail this year waiting for his Nissan team, to whom he's contracted initially years ago as a rally driver, now more recently as a race driver, waiting for them to complete the homologation of their Skyline turbo, 2-litre engine turbocharged, and they failed to meet the August 1 deadline, and so Fury has been let out, if you like, to keep his hand in, and is doing a grand job in this BMW.
And 50 seconds down on the leader, who is Robbie Francevic, John Smiles in the pits. Well, we're not hearing John Smiles down there. Not drowned out by the noise of all the vehicles down in there in the pits, because the ones there aren't making too much noise. That's the problem. But we're still watching third place man Fury in the Crichton BMW.
With all the wires that are strung down there behind the pits, Peter, I'm surprised that any of them are hooked up at any given time. I'm totally amazed by the technical aspects.
Starting to feel perhaps some sympathy for the
considerable amount, and I'm going to go on record, Will. You can stick a camera or a mic in my face anytime, anywhere, anytime. I will no longer
Third place man Fury circulating very nicely. And there's our leader. So you notice different parts of the circuit that they're on. And that's going up the back straight, and that's our leader, Robbie Francevic. And we've got John Smales online again.
Well, for the Mobil Holden dealer team, it's triple trouble in the pits today. First, Brock with his broken rocker arm. Then the Harvey car came in, and they're trying out some new experimental brake pads for the James Hardy 1000. And it's those that have worn right down so that they're totally inoperative only after 20 laps. Then Harvey's car began to overheat. And at the moment, as you can see, they're under the engine, and this car is going nowhere today.
Allan, brakes wearing out after 20 laps here. Even though it's tougher on brakes than Bathurst, still not very comforting coming to the end of Conrod.
A very, very ominous situation, and I'm sure that there's going to be some sleepless nights in that team between now and the time they hit Conrod.
But the point, I think, Allan, is that they're always trying things out, and they're always trying to develop the cars. They're never happy with the status. For instance, there have been months on the dynamometer trying to get more engine power, both up high for acceleration, but also mid-range to punch them out of corners better. And they did have more powerful cars for this meeting. Okay, they've fallen over on this occasion, but it's trying, seeing what works, abandoning what doesn't, that makes them the dominant team that they've been for so long.
How would the brakes on the Marlboro Holden dealer team cars will compare with what we're seeing in Allan Grice, who's second?
It's hard to know.
Well, we have to bear in mind, Peter, that the brakes are very much a function of how hard the driver pushes them.
Denny Holm car in the pits.
He's in fourth place outright. Car number 14, immediately behind Fury in 31, and sandwiched between 31 in third and 55, the Francevic Volvo. In second place is Allan Grice, car number 6. So it's Francevic, Grice, Fury, then Denny Holm, who's done extremely well. He was sharing service vehicles in the recent Wins Safari, driving two long wheelbase Nissan Patrol station wagons, servicing the Gaston Raier Eddie Howe BMW motorbikes. And when they got sprinting towards the end of the event, Holm came home 14th as virtually a service vehicle and George Fury 11th. They did a grand job.
Back to Grice and Rev Kev Bartlett, still giving Gricey a rev up down the front straight.
Yes, watching the Sterian slipstreaming the way it is behind Grice's car.
Well, David Parsons, the Sprayton farmer from Tasmania, has number 7 out on the track again. John Smales said it was going nowhere.
He's pumping those brake pads up like crazy to get the pads
up. It might go
up
somewhere, perhaps off the circuit.
29th outright at this moment.
That's Allan Grice. You've had some top dices over the years, you two Allans.
Yes, up particularly in that neck of Sandown up the back straight. Gracie was always a bit reluctant to put his foot on the brake, actually, and a number of times used my Falcon GT as a battering ramp. But a terrific driver, a fellow that knows how to use his head. He's not afraid to swallow a little pie in the opening of labs there and watching the Mustang and Peter Brock go to a comfortable lead. He's got his tires settled down, hasn't been in the pits yet, and we could be very well looking at a potential winner here right as we look.
And those famous red gloves, I think he's about the first man to wear those. You see them working pretty hard in the car.
I tried those once and they distracted me so much that I went back to the normal ones.
Bartlett behind him in the Starion. Bartlett famous for that big rollover in the Camaro at Bathurst. Gone to a smaller vehicle after some troubles at the start. He seems to have it going now and pushing Gricey.
Yep.
There's the Colin Bond car. 1964 endurance racing started here at Sandown as the Alfa Romeo GTV passes the Commodore up the back straight, and it was an Alfa that took that first race. And on the 21st birthday, Colin Bond's not out of it. He's up to fourth place.
Running second in Class B as well to Robbie Francevic in the Volvo Turbo, leading the, in other words, the 2 to 3 litre class, with Peter Fitzgerald in the Mitsubishi Starion third. So the non-turbo 2.5 litre V6 car sandwiched between two turbo cars, one from Sweden, one from Japan, and this one from Italy. And Colin Bond doing, as ever, a great job. Alan Jones holds the lap record in that class. And Colin Bond yesterday equaled it at 156.9. Was equaled by Colin Bond. And we all saw how hard Alan Jones was driving the car earlier in the season during the Touring Car Championship. Bond really is a remarkably versatile and easy driver, Alan Moffat, I think you'd agree, and a driver who doesn't always go out trying to prove himself, but rather happy to go out and do a very workmanlike job.
Well, he doesn't have to, Will, with the credentials he's got and the number of miles under his belt, driving a very nicely balanced car with a transmission part of the diff on that little Alpha. It's a very nice setup, and he's able to conserve it and no doubt will be there at the finish.
Well, you saw him with the front straight all to himself. Francevic, who leads the race and heads Group B, has a bit of traffic up there, but no trouble as he heads up to the top of the course.
I rode down, you're talking, Peter G, of that first beating long distance race here at Sandown. I rode down on my BMW motorbike to see that. And I remember Allan dancing around in a Lotus Cortina with the front wheel usually about 20 centimetres off the ground, the inside front wheel.
I rode down to that race too, Will, in the back of an Ansett freighter. The car landed in Brisbane and was going to be late for the race. The only way we could get it here was to fly it, and it arrived at Essendon on Saturday morning. I got out of the back with the car.
You were better prepared in later years in your motor racing, but I remember when you used to drag the street to yourself along a bit. I can remember you waiting for the train at Longford when you were late out to practices.
Will, I don't like your memory. You're getting too good with this.
In fourth place at the moment is car number 47. That's the Colin Bond, Greg Hansford, Alfa Romeo, GTV6.
Ray Ellis, Commodore there on the back straight. Car number 13 down in 15th place. Some three laps down on the leading car. Pretty interesting pro hard paintwork on the front bonnet of the Commodore. You'd be frightened to mingle it, wouldn't you?
You certainly wouldn't want to have to be the spray painter responsible for getting it back again.
Prohard paintings are reasonably common because he's a very prolific artist, but not many of them have been painted on the bonnet and boots of racing motor cars.
And just indicating there to car number six, who is our second place man in Alan Grice, where to pass. I don't think it worries Grice too much. He's put that car in between him and Bartlett, but not for long.
I think Alan Grice is very aware of who he's got behind him.
Put the situation up the back. Let's go down to the pits, John Smiles.
All tied up in the pits is John Bauer, and it's a case of really being thrown in at the deep end, John.
Yeah, it is, John. I've only done probably seven or eight laps of practice, and now the car's going so well, and Robbie's opened up a big lead. I mean, I've got to do the right thing, don't I? Not many drivers bring their own seat along with them. Well, he's 6 foot two and weighs a 4 stone more than me. I'm a 90-pound weakling, so I've got to do this so I can reach everything.
It's a much more sensible way than actually trying to adjust the seat inside the car.
Well, this way we don't have to change the seat belts or anything. I just hop in and do the belts up where he wears them, so it's a pretty good idea.
John, have you discussed tactics for your session?
No, Robbie will tell me what's going on when I get in the car, so I'll wait and see.
How close to his pace do you think you'll be in the race?
I don't know, mate. It depends how quickly I settle into it.
John Bauer, thank you.
There, leading Class C, up to 2 litres. Car number 60. That's the Toyota Sprinter of John Smith. The car that won its class in every round but the final one of the Touring Car Championship. Drew Price, the many times Australian go-kart and various states go-kart champion, won that final round in a mix-up between the two drivers. He's 16th outright at this stage, 46 laps covered, compared with 50 by Francevic in the race lead. And there you see the situation in the class. Bob hold in, it should be. And John White is third. John White in a Holden Gemini. That's a twin cam car with two valves per cylinder that in fact is got about 160 horsepower. About the same as John Smith's Toyota Sprinter, which however has four valves per cylinder. Both of them are fuel injected, but it's a light little car. It's only about 880 kilos, this Sprinter, beautifully balanced. And John Smith, a great driver, really. Very, very quick and tigerish in single seaters. It's just the sort of driver needed to fling it around because it hasn't got, well, it's barely half the horsepower of some of the front-running cars and only a couple of hundred kilos lighter. So it needs a lot of vigour to get it around anywhere near a good lap time. And indeed, John Smith does that. He qualified it 24th. He's been 7th and 12th in the two previous rounds of the Endurance Championship. And compared with his lap record for the class of 2 minutes 4.1, John Smith practiced and had a fastest qualifying time of 2 minutes 1.6.
What's the difference between the Sprinter and the Corolla?
Basically the same, and here is the Volvo Turbo. Basically the same model, Peter G, but different names in different markets and for different specifications. But what's wrong with Francevic's car, which is now being overtaken by Colin Bond? He's heading for the pits, but you don't head for the pits at that pace.
Could be fuel.
Unless something's wrong, yes, could be fuel. They've covered 50. He's on his 52nd lap. He's completed 51. And dear oh me, Jim Richards going by, John Smith being held up. And yet again, a disaster for the car that's been leading the Castrol 500 with...
The roar was from the crowd because the Palmer Tubes Mustang is back in the race. Number 17, Dick Johnson.
And I suspect they will give that car plenty.
Dick Johnson went absent from the race on the lap 23 and has rejoined it on lap 51 as Francevic comes into the pits.
This should be one of our better synchronized pit stops. It'll be interesting to see just how quickly they do this, Will. I know you've got the watch on them. Apart from fiddling with that spare seat, which is a novel approach, which we haven't seen on too many occasions. These fellows will want four tires, 120 liters, and down and gone. Anything less than 30 seconds can be considered not quite fast enough.
And that's 27.2.
Well, there you have it, the best stop of the day, I'm sure. And that's how you win races. It stay in the lead, fantastic stop, and get back out there before your opposition even know what's hit them.
27.2, but then again, he lost more time out on the track than you normally lose slowing down and speeding up again, as we look now at a problem apparently under the bonnet of the Bartlett Mitsubishi Starion.
Well, there's the age-old problem with turbochargers, Will. So much heat developed and kept and maintained like an oven under the bonnet that everything just starts to fry.
That's Peter Fitzgerald's number 43, Bartlett's 42. That's the car that qualified sixth and is presently in seventh place. Was until he pitted.
New leader in the race, this car 31, that's George Fury in the BMW. As we see the Hell's Kitchen under the bonnet of the Fitzgerald car. Grice in and out, that's the reason that we've seen the lead change. Grice is now back out on the track and down to third place.
So the man who qualified fastest for this race last year in his Nissan Bluebird Turbo at 146.3, compared in, that's in a Group C car, of course, compared with this year's fastest qualifying time, 152.3, is now leading the race. And down in the pits again, it's John Smales.
And for race leader Robbie Francevic, a real drama. What happened?
The fuel line never worked, so we ran out of gas.
What a huge shame. You hadn't calculated it so your pit crew could call you in?
Well, I thought they'd call me in when we got the required distance. Our car's not good on fuel, and I was amazed at how far we went. And I couldn't see my watch, and I couldn't, so I was calculating it. I thought we must be close. And then, of course, I decided to come in, and on that same lap, it ran out.
How much do you reckon you've lost, Robbie?
Oh, well, I'll have to check with my crew, but the car's good. She'll go all day.
The race pace is really tough, faster than we'd expected.
Yeah, it is, real quick.
55s, thereabouts, 56.
All the time, yeah.
Now, okay, you're capable of keeping that up to the end, do you think?
We can go for 24 hours like that.
Had you expected to see the two V8 favourites, the Brock and the Johnson, disappear as early?
Well, they're the two biggest budget teams in Australia, and they're Australia's best, and it's amazing that they've packed up. And here we are, a little budget team, and we're killing them.
well, I don't know about killing, and it's always the poor boys on the block like to come out with a serenade like that. I, with all respect to Mr. Francevic, would suggest that the Volvo Australia are not the poorest company in the world, and they've got the engineering behind a car that, Will, you've just been to Europe, they've done extremely well over there.
Yes,
that kind of a statement, yeah, everybody always likes to cast aspersions on other people's wealth. Seems to be an Australian necessity. Certainly the Holden Dealer team are well financed. They always have been. They've got great sponsors in Mobil to help them pay the way. But everybody's in the business to win. And if you don't like the name of the game, don't bother starting.
As we see Fury doing a great job, he is like Colin Bond, equally versatile at rallying or racing. In Europe, in the European Touring Car Championship, Volvo lead on 149 points from Rover, 125, BMW 100, and Fury would be absolutely delighted with slotting into this car and doing so well. He's only got the two races in the car, as we see now.
What about
Jim
car?
Richards?
Yes. 28th well, to what?
Fourth.
Fourth.
He's behind Grice and in front of car number 47. That's Colin Bond and Greg Hansford in the Alpha. So the situation is Fury in 31, from Francevic second on the same number of laps, 54 completed, with Francevic. Richards is now third. Then it's Grice fourth in car number six. Fifth in car number 47 is the Bond Hansford Alpha. And sixth in car number 44 is Peter Williamson, Thomas Mazira in the Toyota Supra.
Well, it looked a disaster when we saw Jim Richards, with the benefit of our ABC helicopter, up there on the back straight, and we said, well, he's got no show. But in retrospect now, with the Holden Dealer team and Dick having a lengthy pit stop, his minor adjustment, as it was out there on the track, is now not looking so bad.
And what's the situation with the BMWs? They're looking to go 70 laps before their first pit stop, so they could put a nice brake on the cars immediately behind them.
Yes, well, all year long the JPS team have been running Pirelli tires, and obviously have picked a compound that they knew would hold them through to the halfway mark. They know what they're doing with their fuel management, and as such we may be looking here at Jim, even with that on-track overhaul, as a contender towards the latter part of the race.
And Colin Bond has gone through on Grice. The Commodore may be a little sick, and Bond has gone up into fourth place.
And in fact, we've got the leading five cars, all with 54 laps completed. So the race, as Fury goes over the start-finish line now, he starts his 55th lap, is fairly compressed up at the front part of the field, and we've had four different race leaders.
Well, Will, if Jim Richards, or for that matter, George Fury, can take any one of their BMWs to the halfway mark, have a terrific stop, which their team are certainly capable of giving them, and get back out there, it's going to be rather difficult for anybody else to nail them.
Your old teammate Greg Hansford, due to take over from Colin Bond when they come in for their pit stop in the Alpha.
I'll be watching very carefully, and everyone listening in Queensland will know that I will give an unbiased account of Greg's performance. Great driver. I was delighted to have him in my team last year, and happy to see him getting a few miles under his belt here today.
And a baby due in the Hansford household in a month's time.
Oh yes, lovely Julie, looking after everything as usual.
There's our race leader in his 56th lap. That's George Fury at the controls of one of the JPS BMWs, and some good driving there coming from David Ratcliffe in the Toyota Sprinter, letting Fury which side he wants him to go through on.
Will, I notice a lot of jockeying behind the wheel, a little bit of left and a little bit of right. The fellas are feeling all these cars. The rear tires not being as wide as we are accustomed to in the past, requiring a lot more driver finesse, and I think that's one thing we will see develop out of Group A, are the younger drivers that are capable.
Into the pits, Allan Grice, car number six. He's in fifth place at the moment. You saw him being re-overtaken by Colin Bond in the Alfa Romeo, pushed back to fifth place. And so on his 55th lap, completing 54 past the start-finish line, Grice into the pits. The gap, incidentally, between first and second place. That's Fury from Francevic is 18.35 seconds. Back to third placed, number one, Jim Richards, is 56.8 seconds. And to fourth place, Colin Bond, is 7.53 seconds, an additional 7.53.
Will, on the way out here, I saw a car sticker on the back of the car. It said, Holden, Australia against the world. The world's winning at the moment.
Yeah, well, it's a big world. Australia, I think, still is a relatively small spot. We need to work extra hard to beat the world, Peter.
The Commodore, the only locally made product out there. And the two Mobil Holden dealer team cars out, though. We see Harvey and Parsons back out circulating. And Grice, who is flying the flag, that looks a little nasty. And Grice, just to the left there, you saw him come out of the car.
Yes, well, any time the bonnet goes up, it's...
Well, it seems there's an unhealthy habit starting to form amongst the Holden team. Alan Grice, what's gone wrong with your car?
About three corners from the pit entrance during my stint, I broke the right, went on to second, seven cylinders, because rockers are a weakness with the Group A Commodore engine as it is. I thought it might have been a broken rocker, so I came in and told them, and they elected to put Warren in for a couple of laps while they got the precise tools and the rockers ready. So they're changing the broken rocker now. Hopefully they can get all the bits out and the car will be back where it started.
Well, it leaves a big question mark over Bathurst, Alan.
Oh, there's no question of that. Something like 23 or something starting up there. Brock dropped a rocker early in the piece, and I believe that led to blowing the engine. There's a couple of other Commodores who've got that problem, but that's the teething problems of Group A with our sort of motor cars, obviously.
Pardon the naive question, but is there anything that can be done with cams between now and October 6th?
Oh, that's very unlikely because of the pressure that the other manufacturers have brought to bear over the mere existence of the Commodore. They're all screaming like cut cats, actually. They know they're going to get knocked off next year, so they're making plenty of noise this year. But as you can see, the rocker breaks in half. So they're a standard road rocker, and what do you do in your 308 engine on the road, you know? 4,500 revs all over.
So is it a driver discipline? You've just got to keep off the revs?
Well, you can't get... You have to use something like six. We've limited ourselves to 6.2 in a straight line. Occasionally, you have to leave them to about 6.3, 6.4 to get the car actually in a straight line out of a corner. You know, you can't pull a gear in the middle of the corner. You back it into a tree somewhere. So the engines are running to six grand, 6.2 all the time, and you know, your road engine would rarely see 4 grand. So they're doing a pretty good job, but under this stress and strain, they're braking.
Alan Grice, thank you.
Well, you're seeing the single biggest problem our fraternity has, history repeating itself. That problem we had with our Falcon engines in 1975. You'll recall the famous roller rocker derby we had here, where we pleaded with cams, we pleaded with the GM competitors to give us a go. We couldn't run a standard rocker in the Ford without it doing exactly what's happening to these fellows today. And the weakness I allude to is the fact that our leaders, our governing bodies, can look at a problem like that that took place a decade ago and was hurting teams 10 years ago, is now stopping two or three of the top teams in the country.
Explain the advantage of a roller rocker and how it works, Alan.
The roller rocker was just a trick California speed shop term, Will, that in effect created a little ball bearing up at the top of the engine. Under normal circumstances, there isn't a Holden would break one of those in 50,000 or 150,000 miles. And if they did, they would be redesigned. But for racing, any engine, it has to go to its maximum. And here we have a component that is taking a lot of wear, a lot of trouble. And because there are so many of them in the engine, and it is so needless for a manufacturer to make them for ordinary road use, to homologate them with them has always been something that any manufacturer has been reluctant to do, the old cost factor. But absolutely nothing to do with how a performance engine should go.
There's an old motor racer, or rather a new motor racing adage, that says that if you want to stop a car finishing a race, put a camera in it. And that's unfortunately what's happened to Jim Keogh.
Well, it is unfortunate. We broke a CV joint. It's a $3 part, really. but it's just one of those things. When you renew them, you hope for the best, but sometimes you have that sort of luck. It happened to be the day we had the camera in the car, and we hope that we gave the viewers some good shots of what it's like out there on the track, and maybe we'll do it again next year.
Well, Jim, what is it like today? It seems a very hard pace.
The race is really being driven at quite a fast pace. I would say that the fellas out front are sprinting, and that's why they're falling out at the moment like ninepins, because they are really, I think, forcing too hard a pace to have a real good chance of finishing this race, because there are so many gear changes on this track, and one has to be so precise with every single one of them that it only takes one mistake and you've done your gearbox. And I think those fellows are really running that risk, and secondly, they're running the risk of over-revving their engine, and the Holdens and the Mustang have got a fairly flimsy drivetrain at the top of their engine, valve train I should say, and I think that there'll be a few more of those fall out before the race is over.
So you reckon even though you're in the pits today, you might have made the right decision car-wise for Bathurst?
I haven't got much doubt about that, John.
Jim Keogh, thank you.
Thanks, John.
The day you can buy a CV joint, which is short for constant velocity joint, for $3, people will be very happy.
Yeah.
More closer to $200, I reckon.
Exactly.
Or $300 or $400.
Even in a BMW?
Yeah. Also in a BMW, yes. The parts aren't cheap. They're very sophisticated. John Shepherd, who spent a lot of time working on domestic V8s, is working on one of them. And in fact, it's on Keogh's car, and he says there's some beautiful engineering in it. Anyway, we're looking at Peter Williamson's Toyota Supra, which is in fifth place outright, car number 44. The car that
It's on its wheels.
Yes, it's going round and round, and nobody else is running into it, which makes it very different to what happened to the car at Oran Park. That car, of course, was battered to a pulp at Bathurst last year on the start line.
That was sick.
Battered at Oran Park recently. Peter had to replace almost all the panels on the car, the whole scuttle forward of the car. Really his grandfather's axe. There's almost nothing original left in the car. As we said, it's in fifth place outright. It's a lap down on the race leaders. That's Fury, Francevic. Francevic, incidentally, 19.08 seconds behind Fury. In third place, it's a further 53.4 seconds back to Jim Richards, who's picked up 3.6 seconds in the last few laps. Colin Bond is a further 13.4 seconds back, and then it's a lap down to Peter Williamson, who's sharing this car with Thomas Mazira. Thomas Mazira is a most promising young driver, born in Czechoslovakia, left there a few years ago, and has the dedication and the ability, as far as we can see at the moment, to go a long way in motor racing. He's holding down two jobs to be able to afford his motor racing. Congratulations to Peter Williamson for putting him into the car. He says, I'm going to start saying that I'm 24 years old when I get to England next year, because that's about the age to start working your way up towards Formula One. But in fact, he's 26 years old. He works as a garbageman, and then when he's finished that, he rushes away and does a full job as a contract spray painter. But in Czechoslovakia,
for Peter Williamson,
yes, he could make a lot of money doing spray painting for Peter Williamson. But in Czechoslovakia, he was actually training and had done quite a bit of university work to become a physics teacher.
Well, I think there's only one thing wrong with his arithmetic. He should take 4 years off now, so that when he's 44, he'll only be 40.
There's our leader, and that's George Fury, still at the helm of the JPS BMW. On his 61st lap, 129 laps in this race, followed by Francevic, second in the Volvo, and Jim Richards in the other golden black BMW in third.
And as we look at those placings, remember that Francevic is just going out a fraction to being just over 19 seconds in arrears in second place, but Richards is pulling in time there in third place fairly substantially on both the leader and on Francevic, and is still a potential, I would suggest, race winner. He has 69 laps, more than half the race distance, to make up a total of 62 seconds. He's got to do a second a lap.
What we got there, Will, is a situation where Jim's tanks and Neville Crichton's tanks will be on the low side. They're just coming up towards the half distance, and I wouldn't think they'd go much further past half than they have to. And as such, their cars will be flying a little bit quicker than the Volvo at this stage, and hence gathering time.
Colin Bond in the pits, car number 27, that was in fourth place, obviously slipping back now, but this
brakes
car's
well.
Been running remarkably well.
Removing the brake pads, Will. We're not going to get a 30-second stop here. This is a very tricky job when the pads are hot. Ah.
And the Volvo Turbo, lying in second place, was 19-odd seconds in arrears, as you can see, stationary. Francevic in the left-hand drive car, frantically. Well, it's not Francevic now, it's John Bow.
Perhaps Francevic spoke a little soon in the pits.
Bow obviously knows something's wrong with the right rear.
Well, does he know anything about Volvo mechanics?
It's locked up.
Yes,
the whole drive line is locked up. Look at the skid marks coming.
Yes.
Is it seized solid somewhere, Allan?
It has, yeah, certainly. And he's looking at his tires now. I wouldn't want to be guessing at that. But having had a look at the car at close quarters yesterday, it is a extremely complicated piece of machinery. There are a lot of bits and pieces on that car that are making it a very fine race car.
It's been said of a number of cars in the race, it's going nowhere, and that thing with the rear locked solid, not the fronts, which is not what would might lock up under brakes, really isn't a lot of bother. And we see there, firstly Fury is leading, and then Bond, who is fourth, and all of them in strife. So
the first
four cars, the only one at the moment not in some degree of trouble is Williamson, who's moved up into fourth in 44. And now as Bond comes out, of course, the race leader also, Fury, in number 31.
That was a good stop, Will, considering they were changing front pads. That's not an easy job. And although not a 30-second stop, they certainly didn't waste too much time.
So he comes out just behind our race leader, George Fury.
George Fury, last year, of course, gave Nissan some of its best successes in the Endurance Championship. Not so much luck at Bathurst or in the touring car rounds, but Fury won the opening round of the Endurance Championship. He won at Oran Park, too, in recent times.
So a good, steady driver, Will, and not fussed by too much. He seems to be a very calm fellow, and I think a credit to any team that has him on their books, and he's proving the point here.
Would Howard Marsden get him back to race the Nissans?
Oh, I think he'd be silly if he didn't.
Well, in fact,
I'm sure he's only on loan as such, Will.
He's on loan, and the stipulation was you can drive for any other team as long as it's not Japanese. It wasn't to be a Nissan competitor.
So here's the Pro Hart painted car, and I hope that paint is petrol resistant.
He's lathering up the circuit a bit. That's not much fun. Should be, that's a black flag situation for sure, if there ever was one. The corner marshal should be observing that.
That's the Ray Ellis Bernie McClure Commodore.
Quite a dangerous situation, not the least of which for the driver inside that car. If some of that was to splash onto a hot exhaust pipe, could have an instant fire.
Just been watching Fury these last few laps, Allan. He seems to be getting up on the curbs a little more than he was earlier.
I think he's probably trying to maximize every second he gets. He knows when he has to stop. Always, if something's going to go wrong, it will go wrong at a pit stop, and he wants to get every lap behind him that he can. And he's got his lighter load of fuel at the moment, and
well, Colin Bond's pit stop was 1 minute 59 seconds. And Colin, what went wrong with the brakes?
Well, actually, John, we put some softer pads in because the hard pads that we normally would run in these races, when we put them in, yes, they embed them in, they won't ride, and we're not going to take a gamble on a new experimental set of pads. We went back to the material we used here last year, which made the race, but the pace of the race is much faster. We're up to third outright, and I think that the boys looked, they obviously wouldn't have gone the rest of the race, so it was better to put them in now before they actually wore completely out, and, you know, Greg would have had to come back in for that.
Your pit stop was planned for about seven laps further on. I've never seen Hansford move so fast when you suddenly appear.
I know, it was a bit of a shame because we said we'd come in about lap 70. The problem was that I just started to miss going up the back straight, and I thought, oh, it could be fuel. I'd better pull in now instead of going around and making sure that we're, you know, we're not out of fuel or something like that.
Not that I wish to start a controversy, but your team says that the BMW, Jim Richards, has not passed you on the road since it stopped early in the race. What's your version?
No, I think when he actually got going up the back straight, he passed me then very soon. and then he has come around and lapped me again in the car, and I was just following him before we pulled into the pit stop, so I would imagine be on the same lap.
Fine, Colin Bond, thank you.
Good.
As we look at the BMWs, which are coming around now to complete lap 64, so another half lap or so, they will be at half race distance of a 129 lap race. That's Fury. It will have taken him to over 2 hours and 4 minutes to do half race distance. And his lead at the moment is 67.8 seconds over Jim Richards. So Richards, by my calculation, has lost a few seconds in the last few laps to the race leader, George Fury.
It's like a 1-2 coming up, Will.
At half distance,
at half distance, it's not bad to be able to forecast that. Even the photographer should be able to understand that this is going to be a likely 1-2 finish.
Well, it's a case of obviously not panicking. They qualified the car ninth, George Fury and Neville Crichton. And now, literally at this moment, a couple of corners further on, will be at half race distance. That's the race situation. Crichton from Richards, both JPS BMW 635s. And in third place, Peter Williamson, the 2.8-litre Toyota Supra, pushing out around 230-odd horsepower, doing a great job. And Thomas Mazira, I'm sure, the Formula Ford champion driver, will do an equally good job when he gets into the car, although he hasn't done a lot of laps in it at the moment. And there's the Volvo, now freed up, obviously, in whatever was locking up the back end of the car. John Bow, helmet off, in the car. Oh, dropped the tail. Well, they've done it. They've
still locked up, Will. They're just pushing it in on a jack.
Yes, they're pushing it on a jack. They've undone the, the tail shaft to the car.
The wheels on that jack.
One thing that can lock a car up like that, if it's had an oil leak, which there's been no sign of, but if the oil for some mysterious reason has left the diff, the crown wheel and pinion will seize. Unlikely, but a possibility.
Well, we've seen all manner of mechanical problems here today. 1,000 kilometres of Bathurst, will we have anyone running at the end?
Well, they start 22 more cars, but it gives them a little bit of an advantage.
So away goes the Francevic Volvo, when in second place it went out. And we're looking now at the Toyota Corolla, that's number 60 of Smith, who in the Australian Touring Car Championship finds himself equal fifth. And at this moment in the race is in 11th position.
Yes, the previous Sprinter sort of two-door coupe which John Smith was running has been replaced by the current model Toyota Corolla sedan and one of the sedan derivatives that's recently been released on the local market. Same mechanicals, it's just a body difference to tie in with the car that they're actually marketing in this country, but it's a twin cam motor, whereas the one that they sell on the market is a single cam, much less potent engine.
John Smith coming into the pits now, a man who perhaps has had one of the most spectacular accidents in Australian motor racing at Adelaide International Raceway. He's probably been just about high as Roger Dondas up in the ABC chopper. Oh,
John, as I was saying earlier, he's a great driver and a really tigerish driver. He's had not just one of the most spectacular, he's had several. Adelaide Raceway, he literally could have been killed. It was a fearsome accident in a single-seater car that ended up upside down. And then he had one at Winton in a sports car that was lent to him. It had a Mazda rotary engine in the back, and he leapt over a metre and a half high barrier almost into a spectator area when the throttle stuck open. John's had some exciting times.
Well, a good view of the onboard jacking system that is permitted this year, and a flick of an airline, the four prods go out, and there they go down again. We'll retract all the way up, and off they go. Tremendous assistance to the mechanics, and great for working on the car overnight, not fooling around with it. A lot of jack handles poking out in everybody's ribs. Another aspect that enhances the speed of the pit stops.
Just a routine pit stop for Smith?
It didn't appear anything else. It's great to see a car stop, not the bonnet go up. That's always...
Well, John Bell, what's happened to the Volvo?
John, I think it's, I don't know much about these cars, but it's locked up in the rear end. I think the diff's locked up, and it's bent all the rest of the suspension when it's locked up, so it's not running anyway.
Was it a big bang?
Yeah, I just came around the corner and accelerated, and it went bang and locked up the rear end and locked up both rear wheels.
As I ran down towards you, people are telling me that the drive shaft has actually broken and the diff has then dropped down. Was that just about describe it?
Well, I think the diff locked up first and then the diff housing turned and then it broke the tail shaft. I think the diff housing broke, the diff itself seized up first.
Any warning from it, John?
No, it's got a temperature gauge for the diff and it was on 120 degrees, which is cool, you know, it's been hotter than that apparently, and it was fine.
Thank you, John.
Thank you.
Tasmanian John Bauer there, Francevic Volvo out. And looking now at the Commodore of Gerald Kay and Martin Power, Jag Parts Racing, and a Commodore flying the flag there.
Martin Power had been involved earlier with a Triumph Dolomite sprint and has got this Commodore. And that, in fact, gave the only lady in the race a chance to have a run, Lorraine Orchard, sharing that Dolomite sprint, so that this VK Commodore of Kay and Power, running well up into fourth place. The race leader, Fury, has covered 67 laps. Richards, about 67 seconds behind, and been fairly static on that for a few laps now, has yet to complete his 67th lap. He's on his 66th. And then on 65 is Williamson, Mazira in the Toyota Supra number 44, and then Kay and Power in 24. In 39, Graham Balcott, Wayne Wilkinson, two drivers from New Zealand, and in another Commodore. And then in sixth place in number 14, Denny Holm and Ray Smith in yet another Commodore, the gold-coloured car. Seventh place is number 47, Colin Bond, Greg Hansford, now after their pit stop. And of course, 67 laps, just over half distance, 64 and a half laps was the exact half race distance.
What can we read into the fact that these privateer Commodores are still racing and the major teams are out?
I would suspect RPM, Peter. Most times when rockers become a critical factor, if you back off in the neighborhood of 500 RPM, you can conserve them.
First pit stop for the JPS team. Let's see how they work. And it's the Richards car that's in.
Going into the car, Tony Longhurst, a young former Australian water ski champion who is running well in the series overall. He's had a sixth and a tenth place, but he originally ran in his 323 BMW in the first round at Amaru Park early in August. Then in the second round, on the 18th of August, he shared with Jim Richards in the big car, and obviously is doing the same at this meeting, and a good stop too.
Well, they were wise pulling in Jim first. That's smart team management there, Will. They're practicing on Jim Richards, and now when their lead car comes in, those boys should be able to do it even better for the number one car.
About 32 seconds for the Richards car. There's the car just behind it, so they're working hard.
They were close.
Yes.
There wasn't much in that.
Fury out. Neville Crichton into the car. New Zealand businessman. He's in fact involved now with some Australian companies as well. Enormous number of New Zealanders racing in Australia, and also all seem to be pretty successful businessmen. Mark Petch, for instance, who owns that Volvo. Very successful in a self-made company. An engineer who's designed very successful pumps and seals and things, and now out and still will be in the lead, because the only car that could possibly have threatened him for the lead with a 67 second margin of Fury over Richards was Richards. And in fact, they did an extremely good pit stop in both the cars, but both pitted, so their relativity remains fairly similar.
Did they have two pit crews, one to take over as soon as the others had got the Richards car away?
I couldn't comment on that. I'm not sure. I suspect they perhaps did, but generally the fellows, once they get wound up and are capable of doing a tire change, and that's no easy manner for any of you as well. Racing mechanics sitting back with a Foster's in your hands today. Believe me, it's an act for these fellows to get those tires off, lift the other one on. They're not light. I mean, they're lighter than a normal tire, but they're not that easy. Get the wheel nuts organized and zap them on with those air guns requires a lot of training, believe me.
Well, we're in a funny situation here at Sandown. The Sandown crowd, which is traditionally a very large and enthusiastic one, very vocal, tends to have its heroes. Peter Brock, Alan Moffat was never one of its heroes, but they enjoyed venting their feelings and emotions towards you, Alan. I think you'll remember. And sometimes, I must say, fairly distastefully, I didn't support some of the sentiments that were expressed,
Will.
We're now in a situation that they've lost their heroes in this race. Peter Brock and Dick Johnson, they're dealing with people like Tony Longhurst and George Fury, and of course Jim Richards and his co-driver, and it's a situation very different, and they're settling down and watching a very interesting race, a race that's changed a lot.
It's Neville Crichton, a New Zealander, at the helm of number 31 in the race lead. Plenty of Kiwis racing here at Sandown today.
Well, George Fury, you started way behind the eight ball the first time in the motor car, and now you're leading the race. It must feel good.
Yeah, it's good. It's a fantastic car once you get going, you know. I found it a bit hard in the traffic because going a bit slowly, I bogged down in the gears and I'm just not used to the car, I guess. But once we got going, I think I sat on a steady time, and I hope that's all they expected of me.
Well, you've come into the accolades of the BMW team. Congratulations from every corner.
Thanks very much. Well, it's a top team, and I'm glad to be in it.
George, with your problem with the car, the understeering of the motor car, what was tyre condition like when you stepped out?
It was good. I was getting more used to it towards the end. Yes, the understeering did slow me down a bit, but I mean, I think it'll be different in Bathurst because Bathurst is not as tyre sensitive.
George Fury, thank you.
Thank you.
And George Fury, not a New Zealander, but this car belongs to one Denny Holm, though perhaps after the pit stop for car number 14, which is up into fourth place, it could be Ray Smith at the helm now.
Yes, Denny Holm, world champion in 1967, Will. A great champion, a great Can-Am driver, won 22 Can-Am races for the McLaren team in America.
I was going to say, Alan, that I think winning a world driving championship is a pretty great achievement, but the sort of cars that he was driving, that Can-Am series, ferocious amount of power, and in some instances, lethal aerodynamics. Some of them just took off and pancaked over backwards. And Denny Holm in those McLarens with 8-litre engines just stomped the American scene in the biggest possible way, didn't
they? They never knew what hit them. It was McLaren engineering, and you've alluded to the problem that killed Bruce McLaren, testing a new sports car body in England.
Denny Holm was known as the Bear, allegedly went over there and horrified them all by wanting to drive in bare feet at one stage. Does a lot of off-road motorcycling now. Does a lot of off-road motorcycling, as I said earlier, was in the Wind Safari, driving a Nissan Patrol, supporting a motorcycle team.
Certainly have the right sponsors for this type of business. I saw some lead weights in the back of the car, and I thought surely that the sponsor could have afforded to put a couple of ingots there. We were thinking about it.
They should have at least painted them gold,
at least
look like ingots.
At least. But it is tremendous to see, and this is where international regulations, when they're adhered to by all countries, can be so good for motor racing.
So, as you see, number 17, that's Dick Johnson, back out there on the track. Dick currently finds himself in 30th place. 42 laps completed. The leaders are in their 71st lap. Johnson flying the flag out there. And not as quickly as he was in the opening laps when he pulled out an over 2-second lead in the first lap of the race, only to do another axle as he did in the last round at Oran Park.
And in the car is Larry Perkins. And if we talk of the Wind Safari, you have to talk of the cheeky Larry Perkins in a 1962 Volkswagen Beetle, leading things like Kevlar-bodied Mitsubishi Pajero four-wheel drives, and all but winning the event, and in fact horrifying the local motor industry that a Volkswagen
could still do it.
20-odd years age might beat.
the latest technology, and really they were terrified. And it was only on the last day that Larry crashed the car, only half a K to the first section that day, and was out of the event. But he's a great engineer, great driver, and now trying to sort out the car and to prove it for Bathurst.
Well, another great engineer is in the pits at the moment. His name is Jim Richards, and you'll recall that 10 laps into the event, he stopped. How did you get it fixed, Jim?
Well, we carry a few spares in the car with us, so it was just a matter of, well, finding what it was, which I figured was the relay, so I just put a new relay in, and it started up, and away it went.
What actually happened? Everything stopped? No electric?
Just no electrics. Had no ignition lights, no rev counter, no motor, no nothing.
What goes through your mind at a time like that, Mr. Richards?
I won't tell you.
So what did you do? You simply get out of the motor car?
I just got out, opened the bonnet. There's a little relay on the car that the boys said that if ever it stops, replace that. So I didn't know what I was doing, but I replaced it and it started and away we went.
You jumped into the crowd at some stage. What happened?
No, I jumped out of the car. I stayed on the circuit, but I didn't jump into the crowd.
Jim, the drive back to come from 28th place to 3rd place has been, to put it mildly, electrifying today. How fast were you going?
Well, I was going as hard as the car and I could go without destroying it because we were coming nowhere. If you can lap past anyone else, naturally you're going to pick up some time. You know, and thankfully that's what we did.
Well, you've seen the V8s drop by the wayside today. That must give you some hope for Bathurst.
Sounds very good.
Jim Richards, thank you.
Thank you.
Allan, I think John may have heard your line about jumping to the crowd there for a sixpence back in the early days. Richards didn't have to do it.
But what he did do is give all young drivers a clue that aspire to do exactly what Jim's doing today, is you must have a knowledge of your car.
Tony Longhurst throwing it around?
Yeah, Peter, I was going to say that I think Tony Longhurst is showing a degree of vigour that might horrify Frank Gardner, I'm not sure. You were saying earlier, Allan, when we were talking about Dick Johnson's broken stub axle at Oran Park, that climbing on curb of stones, depending on what angle you are when you do so, is very, very hard on the suspension indeed.
Well, those wheels are meant to go along on the nice flat bitumen, and any time you give them a wallop, the shock wave is transmitted through the car. The springs are there to absorb it. The shock absorbers are there to absorb it. But you can and can't expect a axle, whether it's front or rear.
And there's Gerald Kay's Commodore, and you notice that Richards had to brake very quickly as on the apex of that corner, the Commodore was poking out. It's off now. The blinker's off, so I don't know whether he is going to go into the pits. And there's Richards, Longhurst at the car now, but he just managed to miss Kay there about 30 seconds back. As we see, that could be car 60, Smith. And he's out as well, so that's the end of the Corolla.
And Kent Bagent.
Well, there are a couple of cliches in motorsport that Will Hagen and I said we'd never use again. One of them is a race of attrition. But unfortunately, I'm forced into a situation today where I've got to say that's exactly what it's been. At the halfway point, some 13 cars out of the field of 36 have dropped out of the race. Amongst them, the Peterbrock Commodore, the O'Brien BMW, Dick Johnson was out for a long time and is now back in the race, but hopelessly out of position. Laurie Hazelton's Capri, John Harvey's Commodore. The Volvo, of course, is locked solid behind the pit counter. Fitzpatrick with the Mitsubishi Starion is out. Also, Alan Grice is in the pits, ruining the day, I think, that he took more than 6,200 RPM. Even the little Volvo of Mike Manier has been in trouble and is in the pits today. Bagent is also out on the circuit in the other BMW. So while the V8s have been having troubles, don't believe that it's only the V8s, it's also the six-cylinder and the four-cylinder cars. I mean, for goodness sake, even the little Toyota has been in the pits with troubles, and that's absolutely unusual. So the Castrol 500 at this torture testing Sandown circuit is really taking its toll.
And we saw the Laurie Nelson Mustang did get out of the sand earlier, but it's stopped on the circuit as well. But the BMWs, apart from that electrical problem, have run like clockwork, and it was said that they were obsolete in Group A.
Yes, well, I must say that my forecasts for the race were that a Holden would come through, and based on grid times, they were certainly looking impressive. But cliches or not, you have to finish to win, Will, and you can't get any prizes for having your car broken down in the pit lane or out on the circuit.
This car has lost, let me see, 11 seconds, 11.3 seconds to the Pursuer, the number one team car, now in the hands of Tony Longhurst. And I think we'll find that Longhurst will continue to make a lot of ground on Crichton, he being appreciably the faster of the two, as we see Ray Smith in Denny Holmes' car number 14, signal 31 to Crichton. The outside of him, Neville Crichton. I think we'll find that, as I say, that Longhurst is by far the quicker of the second drivers in these two cars, whereas the lead drivers are more comparable, Richards and George Furey.
That's an interesting point, looking ahead to Bathurst as well.
The white flashes on the wheel there are the Pirelli insignias, which we saw painted on this morning at the last minute just to touch up their tires, and they look a little strange on the black backdrop of the fabulous BMW. For those unfamiliar with what they're seeing, that's what they are, the Pirelli sign.
As we look at the Mobil Holden dealer team and pit Dick Johnson pitting, it's significant that Peter Brock will never display a tyre company logo on his tyres. He says, I pay for the tyres, I'm not giving them any free advertising.
Not that you can really see when they're going at that speed
upwards
anyway.
Upwards of $250 a piece, I can't say I blame you.
Well, you saw the Brock crew there, they haven't got too much to do, but look at the Johnson crew at work. And there's the Williamson Supra. And that car in sixth place at the moment. It's 73rd lap, the leader on the 75th.
In fact, it's pertinent to look at the race situation with Crichton in 31 leading from Longhurst now driving one, the two BMWs. Then in third place, number 24, unless presuming he's still picked up, but the lap chart shows it at the moment, is that Holden Commodore, Joel K. Martin Power. 47 is then fourth, Colin Bond, Greg Hansford. 14, the Denny Holm Ray Smith car is fifth. Then Peter Williamson and Thomas Mazira, sixth. Seventh is car 39, Graham Balcott, Wayne Wilkinson. And then it's car 12, the V12 XJS Jaguar of Gary Wilmington, sharing at this stage with Peter Jansen.
Peter Jansen.
A pair of characters.
You saw the sign on the front of that Jag this morning, Will?
Yes, Royal Dalton.
Royal Dalton.
Looking at the Supra at the moment, though, looks very nice, sits down nicely, drives well out of the corners, Allan, sliding it fairly well, but yes. The car does do a good job, doesn't it?
Very pretty looking car, and with the sloped bonnet V-line, good aerodynamics, could be extremely fast at Bathurst.
There's our second place car, the number one car, the JPS BMW stable, and it's Tony Longhurst at the helm.
He's the pursuer after the car that's given no trouble in the race, the car that George Furey drove into the lead and handed over to Neville Crichton, and which at last measure had a lead of 56.5 seconds, just getting a countdown now to Longhurst's gap, but I think that Longhurst will be peeling the seconds away, and it is of course in BMW's team interests firstly to get a 1-2 finish for the two cars. They lead the championship at the moment with 50 points and 43 for Holden, 32 for Alfa Romeo, but also I think for Jim Richards to get the major points for this meeting rather than whoever shares the second car, so that it'll be an interesting situation. I think probably Crichton's been told to run reasonably gently. The gap now is 52.86 seconds, so it's come back from about a minute 8 seconds to 53, let's say, rounding it out, and so that's an appreciable gain. And they are on lap 75 in a 129 lap race. In other words, there are 54 laps remaining.
People just coming to our telecast, you saw three cars in shot there as you did coming down the main straight, a Mobil Holden dealer team Commodore, the Mustang of Dick Johnson, and then the BMW, but only the BMW in contention to win the race. Peter Brock going out of the race. And then number seven, which is still circulating, spending heaps of time in the pits. So Longhurst, after some frenetic work there in his opening laps, and the car seems to have steadied it down a little bit, Owen.
Yes, well, every driver's got to do what he thinks is necessary. Certainly the driver going in at the halfway mark has had the benefit of seeing the race unfold. He's seen what the opposition have done, and he's also had the team manager there telling him what he wants to do.
Big car, massive car, this Jaguar, 1.4 tons, V12 engine that Gary Wilmington, who with his brother does all the mechanical work, his brother builds the engine, says an engine change takes us about a week. They had to do one on Friday. Really does take a long time. They ran the engine bearings in the motor they intended to run here, and they'd just been running the motor on and on and on. It in fact had done some 2,000 race miles, or sorry, race kilometres, which is fairly impressive. But finally the bearings ran. They've got a much less powerful engine in it today. They took an outstanding, Gary Wilmington did an outstanding fifth place in the series at Oran Park, the second round of the championship, and so has slotted Jaguar with 15 points into sixth place in the series overall. And now sharing the car with Peter Jansen, who'll be driving the car also at Bathurst, who's brought some upmarket, classy sponsorship to the car on the front mudguards
well,
there.
Well, certainly no piece of China, but a great company. I've admired Royal Dalton figurines for many years. Peter can do all sorts of things with sponsorship. He's a great entrepreneur, racer, and this car will probably be quite a force at Bathurst, but certainly the three works cars that are coming.
Yes, how does it compare with the Walkinshaw cars?
Well, I think chalk and cheese would be a fairly good description, Peter. China and cheese, you took the words out of my mouth. The English cars are obviously the epitome of what a Jag can be brought to into fruition, and as such will be a real force on Mont Panorama.
If we're talking of low-budget teams, which we were earlier... and Dick Johnson round in the Mustang. In fact, that's his co-driver, Larry Perkins. Larry's given on occasions to having the odd lose. Doesn't seem to worry him too much. But that's bad luck for him. He's still well down in the field. He's in 30th place. And let's see how it all happened. Larry Perkins, the boy from Cowangee. Here he is. And just
out of order out of the corner. I would say probably just punched it a little bit too quickly, Will, in a low gear that would transfer a lot of torque quickly to the rear wheels, and power oversteer, and around he went.
Yes, it reminds us, of course, how good a job the regular pilots of these cars do. They just know the car backwards. And we very, very rarely see them make a mistake. And that reminds us that a very classy driver like Larry Perkins, who very nearly became a permanent driver in Formula One, can make a mistake. This is Graham Bowcutt and Wayne Wilkinson in a new car that they debuted at Oran Park, and which unfortunately they badly bent on the warm-up lap, stove in the rear of the car, but soldiered on with it. Qualified 17th here, but finished 9th at Oran Park in a good effort.
In 7th place in the race this afternoon, which is 92 laps old. This car has completed, 92 laps to 52 laps to go. This car has completed 75 laps. So it's 3 laps down on the leader. That is the BMW being driven at the moment by Neville Crichton. Wayne Wilkinson perhaps at the wheel at this stage.
Bowcutt and Wayne Wilkinson, I was talking to Denny Holm about them when he got his first look at the Bathurst entries. He said, oh, they're a couple of wild boys. And are, of course, more New Zealanders. And
just how many more of them are over there? They haven't come here.
Plenty of them. And most of them seem prepared to leave.
Well, the big international Group A races start the beginning of the year in New Zealand, Will, and in January all the Australian teams will be making tracks to Wellington and Auckland to show the New Zealanders that we're Australians are race drivers too.
The president of the Australian Racing Drivers Club is Allan Grice. He's not in the car at the moment, car number 6. He's handed it over to Warren Cullen, the man who brought Alan Jones back into motorsport after his retirement from Formula One. Got him into his team at Bathurst. They're currently in 22nd place with, again, another broken rocker. Problem that's plagued several of the Commodores in this race. For all that we're seeing enormous variety in Group A, different brands of motor cars and most of them from Europe, the most popular car at Bathurst and in most of the Group A races now is still Holden Commodore by a long way. I think, if I remember correctly, there are 22 of them entered for Bathurst on October 6.
Well, you're looking at the international dollar rate there too. Well, the cost of building a Commodore is not insignificant. But when you're looking at a BMW being sort of $65,000 to take it off the showroom and then make a race car out of it, it's a logical decision.
Well, one of Peter Brock's arguments against Group A is that he says it's so expensive. He claims he sold Group C Holden Commodores for around $30,000 second-hand and, say, $38,000 new. He says a Group A car is costing people over $70,000 in terms of a Commodore. And, in fact, Charlie O'Brien bought the ex-Frank Sittner car from England. He said, with a pile of spares, including suspension, front and rear, differentials, gearbox and motor, for less than the cost of a new Commodore.
Well,
so you can, this is the interplay again you can have if you're compatible with overseas regulations. As we look at Neville Crichton in 31, leading the race, 78 completed on his 79th, with the Jaguar tucked in behind, but the Jaguar back in 8th place, so 7 placings behind him.
To compare the BMW and the Jag.
Another of Peter Brock's complaints about Group A, and he's not an entirely happy man about the situation, is that, as he correctly points out, cars like BMWs are made to run. They don't worry about mass very much, about the weight of the vehicle. So they're fairly solidly built cars. They're made to run extremely fast in their natural form. A 2.8-litre BMW. In standard form on a German Autobahn, will do 220 kilometres an hour fairly easily. Now, a 5-litre Commodore will do about 190, 195.
Yes, that's a very valid point.
It's a very different situation. This uses a 3.5-litre motor. How they wish they could go to the 4 valves per cylinder engine, because that would rabbit an absolute shell, a real rocket. They're available for them, but not available for Group A.
Well, a lot of things aren't available for Group A, and I think that's one of the real bottom line detriments of the class, that by the time the manufacturer gets himself into the manufacturing cycle, which enables a race team to take advantage of whatever they want to make, whether it be roller rockers or gold-plated crown wheel and pinions, the individual race teams sit around biting their fingernails, losing races, going crazy. A bit like a kid in Disneyland not being allowed to have a candy apple.
They've been racing now for 2 hours and 37 minutes to give us that race situation that we looked at. And car number 31 has been in the lead since lap 52 and has now covered 80 and is on his 81st.
Yes.
One of 4 leaders in the race.
With that kind of momentum now, we'll very hard to stop a team like this. The drivers have got enough nous to nurse the components that require nursing. They've got a big enough cushion, and in this case, the main opposition is their own teammate, a cushion to divide the number of laps left and the amount of tire wear they've got, brake wear, obviously no problem on these cars today.
Have you ever heard quite a crowd here at Sandown?
Well, I have to tell you, when you're in the car, you don't hear them at any time, so I could say, yes, I have heard a quieter crowd, but a less demonstrative crowd would be something, no.
certainly nothing for them to shout about as far as local involvement goes at the head of the race.
They've been enjoying Dick Johnson being back out there and having
the
some
only
little,
time you know they're
little
there,
dices. Really? But in fact, soaking up, I think, the atmosphere of a race very different to what they're used to, but nevertheless a very interesting one. Here we look again at Denny Holmes' car.
I just love that 14. Sponsorship. Well, I can't miss the opportunity to comment this thing. Auckland Gold Bullion Company. That's just tremendous, isn't it?
Yes, I'm not sure quite how big the Auckland Gold Bullion Company is. I don't imagine it's exactly Zurich or Geneva in terms of the money spinning
through.
No. Or
Fort Knox.
Or Fort Knox. But then we see Allan Grice's car in the pits, car number 6, that's in 22nd place at the moment, but with further problems.
Allan Grice might be able to bake some bread under that bonnet.
And incidentally, the lead of Neville Crichton has been chiselled back to 48.1 seconds. So Tony Longhurst is peeling in appreciable ground.
Well, they've got a great situation there, Will, with two cars in a 1-2 situation, apart from discounting the advertising potential of ensuring that the 1-2 position stays where it is. If I was Frank Gardner today, I would be asking that second car, which in this case is the number car number 1, to go for broke and get up there and hammer the car hard and in, as such use these laps here at Sandown to get an insurance policy on durability for Bathurst. Bear in mind all these cars are stripped after this race and gone through with a fine-tooth comb for checking for anything that might have cracked or wear rates they didn't like, oil seals that looked like they wouldn't go 1,000 kilometers, things of that nature. You don't get that kind of a wear pattern. You can't analyze or take advantage of a win if you haven't driven the car hard. So even if 31 cruises to a reasonable steady finish, I'm sure the data that they will get out of the other BMW will be the most significant factor.
As indeed are people like Allan Grice and Dick Johnson, Larry Perkins, learning plenty today, which of course is why Dick Johnson sent Perkins out in the car to continue running. He was to find out whether any other items would give them problems.
Yes.
Obviously one has, as Larry rolls to a halt, and I think spells the end for car number 17 today, that's in 28th place at this stage.
Well, he'll have treated that broken axle as a blessing in disguise, Will. Awfully nice to know that if it was going to break at Sandown, or that it has broken at Sandown, it was absolutely certain that it would break at Bathurst with the pounding the car gets there, going off the mountain, down through the dip.
The lead, 47.28 seconds, Crichton to Longhurst, but then our Gold Bullion friends are in 7th place. Ray Smith, Denny Holm, the man out of the car.
Denny Holm, it must be a big thrill for a few of the drivers in the race to be running against a world champion. How does it feel for a world champion running against a few of these hotshots?
It doesn't really faze me, I suppose, because I know a way back I set out and I won the world championship, so I've achieved my goal. So now I'm here just enjoying myself, running against Dickie Johnson, Peter Brock and all that. I know they're going to really go like anything tomorrow. I'm just going to enjoy myself.
By enjoying yourself, do you mean mixing it with them, hanging back?
If I could run with them, I'd mix with them. But it doesn't faze me that if I can't run with them, I don't get disturbed about it at all. And I just run my race to be there at the end of the 500.
Does it frustrate you at all being in a car of limited power compared to that which you were used to?
No, because I feel it's the same for everybody, and so it's a technical exercise, and I get quite enjoyed in getting involved in the technical exercise of getting this car around here as quick as possible. In the Can-Am series, which we won an awful lot on, there was unlimited horsepower, and all that meant was if you did make a little mistake at one corner, you just kept your foot in it down the straight a little bit longer and you made up for it. So that was a power exercise.
Danny, what's the future for you?
Well, I would like to think that I could race around the mountain longer than Bob Holden, but he won't retire, so I got a few years to go yet.
Denny Holm, what, around 50?
Yes.
Something like that?
Yeah.
Age has got nothing to do with ability, gentlemen.
It's very interesting looking through the ages of the drivers. that crop that came up, yourself, Brocky, Johnson, they're all of a similar age, getting up to mid-40s. What's coming down below them? We seem to have a gulf in ages in Australian drivers at the moment.
There is a bit of a problem, but these things overcome themselves, and drivers pop up from nowhere, and as the younger drivers who are trying see opportunities available to them and ask the question, it's surprising what can happen when you physically ask somebody for a drive. I know I had to do a lot of it, and funnily enough, a lot of people said yes at the right occasion. And I think perhaps if the younger drivers that may be listening took that tip and weren't afraid to let the Holden dealer team and the JPS team know that they're available, and just be at any given point, at any given time, to test drive a car. Team management today are so busy getting their own act to the start line and going through the rigmarole they have to maintain their own teams. They're not really out canvassing to see who is the greatest driver on the block.
In fact, we're seeing a few young ones get a chance here today. People like Thomas Mazira and David Parsons has been a regular in the Holden dealer team for a while. They're people with talent and who are benefiting from good team management, good vehicle preparation and so on. And it'll come through if they've got the talent and the perseverance, and many of them are showing it in their dedication to make the money and commit a very large part of their income and their wherewithal to motor racing.
But, I drove in a car park for a number of months, Will, to keep sustenance in between races in my young career. You just have to do it.
Neville Crichton is now 45.97 seconds in front of Tony Longhurst. So it continues to reduce, and they've completed 84 laps, so they have, it's about a second a lap, it's just over 1 second. So there's 45 laps remaining and 46 seconds to be made, and I would say, all going well, that we're going to see a BMW finish 1-2, very close together across the finishing line.
When they do get to that situation, what will be the team orders from boss Frank Gardner?
Well, in this case, Frank is the boss.
Thinking back to Bathurst with you and Colin Bond, Allan.
Well, in that case, I was the making the decisions. And as such, Colin knew what he had to do, and he did it very gracefully. There are a number of ways of setting a team up. And if your lead driver, as the case with my Peter Stuyvesant team was, also the honcho, so to speak, in the BMW's case, Frank Gardner runs the team, and the drivers are guided by his decisions, and so they should be. Peter Brock, irrefutably, runs his team, and nothing should be taken away from the fellow who is behind the wheel running the team.
We saw the Colin Bond car there in fourth place, number 47, the Alpha, as we see work being carried out on the Perkins Johnson Mustang. There's the remaining Holden dealer team car of Parsons going through. And this is Colin Bond. He'd love to win this race. And unless something happens to leading BMWs, I think this will be the year. As we see the Jaguar, the sole one in this race, pulling off onto the side with the captain at the wheel.
Well, attrition is certainly starting to add up. John Smales alluded to the arithmetic earlier. 36% of the race is gone. This is probably taking it to 40% of the race out. Doesn't augur well for anybody that wants to make 1,000 kilometers, not able to make 500.
That's Peter Jensen getting out of the car. He looked fairly at home in the green sward there. I think perhaps brought about by his affinity to polo.
Back to Colin Bond, circulating in fourth place. Co-driving with Colin this afternoon is Greg Hansford. And that is Greg at the wheel, or is it Bond back in?
I think it is Greg. And I also hope that he isn't sipping on some of his sponsor's good product there. He wouldn't be going too far if he did, drinking and driving at the same time. Greg handling the car nicely. This fellow is definitely not going in the right direction.
Wayne Wilkinson in the Bouquet car. A little spin there.
We're starting to see a little bit of dragger fatigue slipping in here. Concentration, heat of the day, sun's starting to come out. Whether the sun's up or not, it's always hot inside a race car. And after a number of laps, drivers can go off the boil a bit, and that's when problems develop.
So, leading the two BMWs, car 31 at the moment is in the lead, and that's the second car in the stable. Neville Crichton, George Fury's airing that one. And there they are, there on lap 87, 129 laps in this event.
And the gap now is 43.9 seconds, and there are 43 laps remaining. There's still that extra 9-tenths of a second, but Longhurst isn't pulling in, as we see again the John Harvey, David Parsons car. With most things going wrong, it's one of the things that motor racing has going for it, that when something goes wrong, usually most things go wrong. And what looks at and is a pretty slick team effort can sometimes start to look fairly harried. The steam pours out. Perhaps tyres go flat. You remember last year the fun Parsons had with a door that kept flying open in the car?
That would be quite nervy.
And he's got it back to 12th overall. He's not going any further.
Not as bad as Vern Schuppen having his door going off at 220 miles an hour in the Mulsanne in France.
Well, indeed, torn off the car. Maximum speed in the Porsche 956.
Williamson Supra goes under the Dunlop Bridge, and perhaps going into the pits is the car in third place. Thomas Mazzera at the wheel, and in they go at fairly decent speed.
Position between the waiting tyres, on go the air jacks built into the car. A refueler on the right-hand side at the rear, and the man letting the air out of the fuel tank and the relief valve on the left. And the new Avon tyres going on around. Thomas Mazzera out, Peter Williamson in. And while that's going on, I just note that for the first time, Longhurst has lost ground to Crichton in the lead. The lead going back out to 44.4 second gap.
And with this pit stop for the Williamson Mazzera Super, Colin Bond into third place, and a bit of a look under the bonnet there.
Anytime the bonnet goes up, rather safe than sorry. Naturally, it's easier to do a quick service while the car's in the pits, and better than it is done rather than breaking down on the circuit. But it it detracts from your ability to have a half a minute.
Topping up with oil there?
It appeared to be. Those oils might not be oils, mate, but they still got to be in there.
As we see from the air, the race leader, Crichton, who, as I said a moment ago, for the first time in many laps, has actually pulled ground on Tony Longhurst in hot pursuit. So he's just making Longhurst's task a little bit longer, because it's now more than a second a lap needed for that car to lose the race to its teammate.
A slow stop from Peter Williamson, 1 minute 7 seconds, but sitting where he is, some 1 minute and 30 seconds ahead of his next competitor on the road, he can afford the time. Peter Williamson has adopted a principle that Alan Moffat did with Greg Hansford. He's found a young bloke with a lot of potential and put him into the team, and Thomas Mazzera, in his first drive with the team, has acquitted himself very well today. Thomas, how do you feel?
I felt good because I think I did the job that I was expected to do. I didn't try too hard, and I didn't want to go too fast, I didn't want to go too slow. I just wanted to stay on the track and get used to the car, because I had only 7 laps in a car yesterday, and now when I was out, that was, you know, my biggest practice.
Thomas, you've driven superbly well in Formula Ford this year, in fact winning the Australian Championship. Do you see touring cars as your future?
In Australia, definitely, yes, because that's where the monies are and all the publicity. open wheelers in here, they just bit behind, and I don't think they will pick up. And my future as an open wheel driver, that'll be only in England or in the States, I think.
So what decision do you make now that Peter Williamson's made you this offer with the team? Do you stay here or go to Europe?
I haven't got anything for next year, but I will be at Bathurst in 3 weeks' time for sure. And for next year, I don't know yet. I can't say.
What's your own preference?
I would love to have a try, and I'll go to overseas and try bigger formula in there. I mean, open wheelers. And if that won't work, then I'll come back and start in a touring car.
How do you find the touring cars here, Thomas? Is it an easy car to drive?
I wouldn't say easy. I think I'm in a stage where it's very hard for me because I got used to open wheeler, and that's, you know, so much different. And I was doing very hard, you know, today, and next time I think it'll be a bit easier for me.
Thomas Mazzera, congratulations on your Formula Ford win this year and also on your move up with Peter Williamson in the Toyota Supra.
Thank you. Also, I'd like to thank Peter and all his crew because I'm very happy they give me the chance.
There haven't been too many Czechoslovakian drivers making an impression in world racing, but he's talking about going to Europe, and Mike Thackwell, the young New Zealander, has just wrapped up the 3000 title.
Indeed. Mazzera is a very determined man. He's written to Reynard Cars, actually, asking if he can work there as a mechanic, helping build cars and take up an offer they made to him earlier in August, and he hasn't heard back yet. But I hope he goes somewhere.
Let's advise him to write another letter, Will.
Just what Alan Moffat was saying earlier. Let him know. I think switchboards at racing headquarters around the country on Monday are going to be jammed with young men out there wanting to get into motor racing.
Well, if you don't ask, you don't get an answer. And what that young fellow is just talking about is the plague of Australian motorsport at the moment. We haven't seen a world champion since
Dick Johnson. But Dick Johnson reviving the Mustang yet again.
Well, unfortunately, they're not on the wind safari today, Will. They're at the Castrol 500, and the idea is to stay on the circuit. But I'd like to make the point about the young fellow who's got the right approach, but wants to become, as all young drivers do, ultimately a world champion, and he can't survive in Australia driving a single-seater. He has to drive a touring car to get even a paid job or any hope of any potential sponsorship. And 20 years ago was exactly the decision that I had to make in my career.
The 2 to 3 litre class, interesting. 2.5 litre Alfa Romeo V6 leading the class. Number 47, which is lying, I might say, third outright, and a very creditable placing indeed, from Peter Williamson, Thomas Mazzera, who is sixth outright, but on the same number of laps in the Toyota Supra. Both of them non-turbo cars, the Supra 2.8 litre inline six-cylinder, and of course Colin Bond sharing with a personal friend in Greg Hansford, as we see the Ford Escort. Ken Harrison, Ian Wells, who didn't get a qualifying time. They were 36th on the grid position out of 36 as Johnson brings his car back to the pits. I think what he'd done was that Larry Perkins had parked it and abandoned it, and Dick Johnson thought it was no good spot to leave a useful Mustang, and has gone back out and retrieved it, and now come round to the pit crew and said, I've got some more work for you to do. You can change the wheels yet again, and I'll see if I've got anything else on the schedule as well.
You must like an oil and grease while you're at it.
Loves giving his sponsors value for money, Dick Johnson.
He does indeed, but he also, of course, loves to find out all that he can heading for Bathurst. This, of course, is a brand new car, as I was saying earlier today, as Brock was debuting a brand new car, whereas the BMWs are the old team cars that have run all through the year, and in fact are the only cars that haven't had any changes allowed as from the beginning of August.
Back in 1977, Alan Moffat and Colin Bond staged their now famous 1-2 Ford victory at Bathurst. Frank Gardner from the BMW team, the way that Longhurst is pulling in Crichton, you might have a 1-2 finish on your hands and it won't be staged.
That'd be nice to think about it, wouldn't it?
Well, he's pulling him in about a lap, a second of a lap.
He's on target to be there, but of course it can all alter. There's 30-odd laps to go. But we're looking a lot better than we were with Jimmy parked at the roadside in the early stages of the race.
Sure were. If the two cars do come together, let's say a couple of laps from the finish, are team orders in progress?
Thank you for that commercial, Dickie Johnson. There are no team orders in... We'll sort the race out. I think... I don't think Tony will catch him anyway. I think Crichton could just hold him off.
Were he to catch him, Longhurst could see a checkered flag, and he's a young bloke. He's the sort of fellow who'd like a win.
Well, he's got his whole life ahead of him to do just that, but if he's there and he's good enough to win, well, fair enough. But there are no team orders, but we're not about to jeopardise our motor cars at the same time.
Can I ask you the hypothetical question? If Longhurst did try for the win and in fact jeopardised the car, what would you say to him afterwards?
He might have a sore posterior.
But he'd still have his place in the team, Frank? Frank, you must be very pleased with the way the BMWs have gone today when, as you say, at lap 10, things were looking horribly dark.
We certainly weren't looking the greatest prospect with Jimmy broken down over the back and George lying back in about sixth spot. We've reversed into a few places today thanks to, thanks to other people's misfortunes. But the name of the game is endurance racing, and you have to put a car together to finish. And we've yet to finish today.
Frank, the Holdens especially have run into all sorts of problems in the upper engine area. If they try something with cams to try and get some modification homologated between now and Bathurst, what would your attitude be?
We've got a rule book and it's Group A, and if you make it, you can race it. The days of the hot rods are over. If the stuff is no good and it's falling to bits on the racetrack, it's falling to bits around the road. That's the idea of Group A racing, to improve the breed. It helps normal John Citizen on the highway. And you can't have hot rod bits in these things, and this is why, if it's not good enough, it will fall to bits.
You spent the last 2 years telling me that the rule book didn't exactly suit the BMW and certainly suited the Holden. It must feel good to have the boot on the other foot.
Well, it was character building stuff over the last 4 years, I must say. It's nice to be on equal terms anyway.
What happens next year, Frank? Do they get what they want and leave you behind the eight ball again?
No, they still have to be able to make it and prove the numbers. And if they make it and prove the numbers, so be it.
What tricks do you have up your sleeve? Will you stay with the 635 or will you go to the little 325 people have been talking about?
The 325 doesn't really come into existence until January, and it'll be December before we know whether it's quick enough. We will have one of each, I think. We'll run the small car for Tony and the large one for Jim for a while.
How much life has the 635 then got left in it? Race life.
It's a jolly good motor car. It's hard to... it's like trying to shoot a good racehorse, isn't it? Although it's not quite winning, it's still there.
Frank Gardner, thanks very much, and let's hope in 40 laps time they're both still there for you.
I hope so too, John.
Frank Napoleon Gardner with the hand inside the coat there. Not suggesting that he runs his team like that, though a few kick backsides might change things if the scenario came through that John Smiles was putting to him there. But Allan, you nodding your head at some of the comments from Frank there as regards, well, as he called it, the hot rod class.
I think you're seeing every time someone comes on camera, certainly I've had a blast earlier, the frustrations coming out of the team, the teams, the management of the teams, in their approach to cams. There isn't anybody, whether it's the Brock team saying, well, golly, we really need a few bits. And Frank's made a very good point. If cams rolled all over on that and there were roller rockers in the Holdens at Bathurst, then every one of the national council that runs our governing body need to be shot. And I hope they're all listening to me say that. I'll supply the bullets if necessary. Frank's got a point. If it's in the rules and they make them, fine. And the Holden will be extremely competitive next year.
In fact, it's all very hypothetical and almost irrelevant because the rule book's there and it can't be done.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's a hypothetical situation that Frank knows can't happen. The situation actually that he was talking about and is far more relevant to the race is the gap between the lead, and Longhurst has now come down inside the second a lap. In three laps he's gone from 36 and a half seconds to 35 dead and to 32.99, say 33, and he has 36 laps in which to get to the lead. So I think we may well see a challenge by the number one car on car number 31, which is leading the race. But
I wonder, though, if Longhurst is using more fuel in so doing and might put himself into a second pit stop situation.
All drivers, if they've got two brains to rattle between their ears, know the fantastic publicity value of having a 1-2 finish and having the two cars side by side as they go over the line. And it could be very much a case, Will, that the 31 is just going so conservatively to ensure a finishing position that the number one car is closing and starting to look good. And if I can allude to a 1-2 finish that happened a number of years ago, that's exactly what happened with Colin and myself. I was in the lead situation. I did ease off. He was almost a lap and a half behind me. He came up on me, and just about the same time he arrived on my back bumper bar, my brake pedal went to the floorboards. It was never a question of whether it would be a challenge for who would go over the line. Because even if you go over the line side by side, dead heat, the organizers will say whatever car started further up on the grid will win the race. So you can't win by trying to be equal. There's no such thing.
Well, the Marlboro McLaren Formula One team have had that problem this year, and their team bosses say there's no number one driver.
Denny Hulme at Le Mans also. In the Ford GT40s. The gap now is 32 seconds. Leader to second place, Neville Crichton.
There'll be no question, well, that the last 10 laps, these two cars will be circulating side by side, stem to stern, and doing a great job for their sponsors, JPS and BMW.
Provided someone doesn't get in their way, Graham Bowkett and Wayne Wilkinson can't there.
Well, they have the benefit of not having Dick Johnson, Allan Grice, Peter Brock, John Harvey. There's just few of those young hopefuls that are no longer in the race. It is somewhat of a laid-down misery for them. But credit to the team. You don't win any race by luck. You win it by good presentation and good preparation, and they've got both at the moment.
Interesting to look at the situation, not only relevant between one and two, but between them and the rest of the field, because Crichton and Longhurst in cars 31 and 1 have completed 94 laps, coming around to complete 95, where in third place, car number 47, the Colin Bond Greg Hansford Alfa Romeo GTV6, of 1 litre less capacity than the BMWs, has completed 92. Just coming up to complete 92 is Peter Williamson Thomas Mazira in the Toyota Supra, which it's interesting to remember as the Mitsubishi Starion of Brian Sampson runs into problems. Interesting to be aware that the Supra is 300 cc's bigger in engine capacity than the Alfa that's leading it, also has done 92 laps. And again, we see Brian Sampson's car number 54. Then also 92 laps completed is number 39 in fifth place, Graham Bowkett, Wayne Wilkinson. In sixth place is number 14, Denny Hulme, Ray Smith. Seventh place, number 24, Gerald K. Martin Parr. Eighth place, 36, is Graham Lusty and Ken Lusty. And ninth, 13, Ray Ellis, Bernie McClure. Tenth, finally, 57, Bob Holden, Glenn Clark.
So we watch the Bowkett Wilkinson car. We saw Brian Sampson having a bit of trouble there. He finished second in the race preceding this, the Cam's Australian Drivers' Championship. Victory going in that race to Peter McCrow, with John Bow, who's won the first four rounds of the championship, deciding he would stay out of it and concentrate on the Castrol 500. He was with the leader for a time, Robbie Francevic, but they're now out of the race.
Indeed, Mazira decided not to take part in the Formula Ford race on a similar basis here today. Wilkinson and Bowkett doing a good job in the car that suffered that horror at Oran Park of a crash on the warm-up lap, but still soldiered home to a very respectable ninth place at the finish, qualified 17th here, and emphasises again that high qualification position doesn't spell success in a race that's 503 kilometres long. Neville Crichton, 32 seconds in the lead over the fellow JPS car that these days is looking just a little bit fancier and more golden with the laurel garland around the JPS to say we've won a few this year, including the Australian Touring Car Championship.
and 15 races out of 18 starts to Jim Richards, which really is a phenomenal situation, and is going perhaps to 16 out of 19. Who knows? The gap actually now is 29.13 seconds, and 96 laps have been completed, so 33 remain.
And it looked like the Lotus in the World Championship of Ayrton Senna might be showing those colours too this season, but that early season promised hasn't eventuated.
Yes, they'll come good in due course.
In Adelaide, do you think, Alan?
Yes, well,
I was at Monza last weekend, and Senna, of course, qualified beautifully there and ran well during the race, came into a nice placing. One of the real talents in Formula One at the moment. If they had the qualifying power that the Formula One BMW has, well, then would be much closer to the front. It is absolutely mind-boggling how much power they're getting out of a 1.5-litre, four-cylinder BMW, turbocharged, Alan. They are using 5.5 atmospheres of boost in qualifying. Unbelievable. Why the engine doesn't explode, you wouldn't know, although it's only in for a few laps just for qualifying. BMW says, we don't know how much power the motor is developing because our dynamometers go only to 1,050 horsepower. It's putting out something like 1,100 horsepower. Alan Jones told me, he said it's putting out 1,270 horsepower. But BMW say, no, probably closer to 1,100. And it was doing 333 kilometres an hour down the straight in the hands of Nelson Piquet. Just phenomenal.
That's an F111 on the ground.
Well, 5.5 atmospheres of boost, where the Mitsubishi Starion's here, he's 1.4. It's a slight difference.
Well, heaven forbid, but perhaps the future Group A will be small capacity engines and big boost turbos.
Well, the story goes that Piquet, of course, is driving next year for Williams Honda.
Yes.
And when he started telling the Honda engineers, as he is now doing, what they've got in the BMW, their oriental eyes were popping. They couldn't believe that they were using so much boost and that Honda was in fact so far behind. Peter Williamson in and out of the pits again. Car number 44 still holding third, well, still holding, now in third place. The Alfa Romeo is in fourth. And that's been an interesting battle through this race, actually, the swapping of places among the various 2 to 3 litre cars. Of course, we've lost a number of them, including the Francevic Volvo, but the Supra and the Alfa Romeo GTV6 have been swapping places fairly regularly.
Just coming up on Ray Ellis and Bernie McClure in their Commodore. Don't seem keen to let them through, and a coat of Prohart paint between that and the Williamson Mazira Supra as they finally got through up the top of the back straight.
Yes, I said they'd come up to third. They showed in third in one lap chart, but our chartist says they're fourth. We believe him. And so the Alfa is still in third.
The Gemini giving room there is John White, there's Sidorowski in their sole small General Motors product out there this afternoon.
37 years old, John White, and doing a good job in that car. So too have Mazira. Most impressed with Thomas Mazira, of course, the way that he's run in Formula Ford over a long time. As I said before, his dedication to the sport. And in Peter Williamson, his mentor, we might say, nearly 20 years older than he, whom I used to see, whose long, lanky frame used to poke up out of single-seater Renmax racing cars back in the Warwick Farm days. And still as keen on his motor racing and his skiing, Peter Williamson. He's much given to skiing in America.
Terrific shots from the helicopter today, Will.
Indeed, it gives us a new perspective on this very tight circuit, 3.9 kilometres around. It was built with the hope of holding a World Championship Grand Prix here. We look at Denny Holmes' car, Ray Smith's, number 14. That car, eighth place at the moment, 91 laps completed, seven down on the leading BMWs.
What happened to the World Endurance Championship?
Well, we had it here last year, of course, and this year, Sandown organisers said they couldn't afford to organise it, and they wouldn't be so doing.
and there was some talk of it going to surfers. When I was at Monza last weekend, Derek Ongaro, who is the FISA circuit safety inspector, said he was coming to Australia in the very near future to check both Surface Paradise and Adelaide for compliance, safety and so on. But the information was that Surfers wouldn't be conducting the race either, and so it has lapsed. And of course, with the emergence of Adelaide as a Formula One street circuit, then I don't think Sandown has any chance of holding a Formula One race. So, in other words, today we're looking at both a very varied race at Sandown, but also what is now Sandown's major race, and one that over the years has been a very successful one for it, a most entertaining one that's always drawn very, very large crowds.
Well, you may have seen from the chopper shots that the crowds aren't here today, especially up in the old Marlborough country where they used to hang out in their droves. But
it's a day that I think out in the open deterred a few people. It looked miserable at the beginning of the day. This cloud has cleared a bit and given us some sun throughout the day. The grandstand's well packed.
People like their comfort these days.
And magnificent grandstand here at Sandown, which has almost always been packed, and I'll always remember that incredibly emotional welcome that that packed grandstand gave to Juan Manuel Fangio when he appeared here. It just about brought tears, I think, to the eyes of about half the people in the grandstand, including many of, I think, all the Argentinians resident in Australia. Was just a sensational meeting. And there have been at Sandown some brilliant motor racing moments.
Of course, a race course as well.
It's a delightful facility which motor racing very much needs. It needs this sort of pretty surroundings, very expensive grandstands. You can see the residential areas nearby that in fact limit its use and limit its use for testing. The residents are not too keen on too much noise tearing around here during the week. And then that's the old back straight, but it shortens and suddenly cuts left at the top left frame of the picture there and comes into this new infield area that's part of the area that gave it its new length to build it up to the required 3.9 kilometre distance for an international race instead of the 3.1 that it was. All this section around the back, very nearly joining up, in fact it does, around to where the back section of the circuit previously went. It jammed down there from the top of picture down to Dandenong Road corner, but then the circuit changed and wiggled again a little bit in the section was slower over the causeway. Round here is different, and it was slower over the causeway and very much safer than a corner that had brought several people undone, including Kevin Bartlett and Pete Gagan, Alan Hamilton, and then round onto the straights and to that superb new pits complex with the white roofs there. That is a magnificent area in which to fettle a car. And thank you very much from Roger Dundas, doing what I'd love to be able to do, piloting a helicopter.
Would you like to be Peter Holmes, though, hanging out the window of it with a camera?
No, I am terrified of heights. A total coward who came down from Ayers Rock on his backside.
Well, there's our race leader, car 31, and at the helm of it, Neville Crichton, on lap 101. In fact, coming up to start their 101st lap. And the checkered flag is in the sights for the JPS BMW team. Second place held down by Tony Longhurst and Jim Richards.
Racing 3 hours, 17 minutes and 14 seconds. And to recap again on that early race situation, which in the opening part of the race, we had Dick Johnson lead from the opening lap until lap 22. Peter Brock lead for the next three laps to lap 25. Then car number 55 went into the lead. That was Robbie Francevic in the Volvo Turbo. And he led until the end of lap 51, and on lap 52, it was George Fury driving car 31 who went into the lead and has not since let it go. Quite an economical car, the 3.5-litre BMW. Two valves per cylinder, fuel injected in standard form. The Mustang, the Holden Commodore, carburetted cars, which tends to be a little bit less efficient and generally throws a bit more fuel at the engine to get the same sort of job done. You generally get more power out of a fuel injection motor, so if you use the power, it can use more fuel, but it is actually more efficient in the power it delivers for a given amount of fuel used. You see Dick Johnson there.
And perhaps just hurrying up Crichton there, both of them sliding.
Just love to have a... just let people know he's there, and in a situation, of course, which he's a free agent, really, in the Mustang number 17. Nothing to worry about, nothing to prove, can do what he likes, whereas Crichton has a very different task on board indeed. That's to keep the whole thing in order and not to be called the person who let the situation go.
Well, we see car 39 in fifth place. That's Barkett and Wilkinson, and a bit of fender damage on the left-hand side. Perhaps they're coming together and may have sustained a flat tyre. There it is, yes, definitely, left-hand front. There's plenty of smoke, so perhaps body touching somewhere.
No, it's the right front.
Right front has gone flat.
Having difficulty steering it. He's had a bingle on the left front, but I think the tyre is still up, but a puncture on the right for sure.
Perhaps just trying to crystal ball a bit. The right front going flat has perhaps caused the coming together.
The BMW situation update. 27 laps remain, 102 completed, and the gap is 22 seconds. So Longhurst doing better than the second a lap, and I...
Rally cross.
Further problems for Balcott Wilkinson. This really is very bad luck for them. The car that's in fifth place outright at the moment, four laps down on the leaders. But I agree with Allan. I think Crichton's doing the pace that will get Longhurst with him as much as anything else and make a very attractive black and gold finish. So as Balcott and Wilkinson go into the pits, the car they have to worry about is one lap down on them. That's number 36 in sixth place. Graham and Ken Lusty in another Holden Commodore VK. Followed in car number 13 by Rail and Bertie McClure, also Commodore. Good quick stop, one tyre and out.
Service not offered to the everyday motorist. Plenty of rubber building up on the sides of the circuit. As you hear the roar, Johnson makes a move. Doesn't quite get him. Under brakes. Close enough to have a go next time.
They love it. And Johnson's gentleman enough to say, I'm certainly not going to do anything to damage your prospects, Neville Crichton, but by gee, I'm going to make you uncomfortable. And there's little doubt in my mind that very soon Crichton, yes, will let him through.
You'll hear the roar going up the back straight. The crowd can see it. Perfect view of it, as you have at home. But Crichton's not going to let him without a fight. And at the top of the circuit, Dick Johnson gets Crichton. Dick Johnson down in 25th. Crichton in the lead.
It's indicative of what a V8 might do on mountain straight, Bill. Just a little bit of extra horsepower, extra displacement in this case, but overall horsepower naturally.
When Johnson went past in those early laps, that Mustang motor was sounding well and truly on song, and a bit of a glisten in the eye there, Allan.
There's nothing nicer than the sound of a V8 on tune, I say.
This might be costing Crichton a bit of time, because the lead is now 18 seconds only. And that's just in one additional lap. He's dropped 4 seconds to Tony Longhurst.
Well, whenever your attention or your concentration is distracted by another driver up alongside you, virtually taking your door handles off, it's only natural that your overall lap time is going to suffer.
Alan Moffat, Mazda out of racing at the end of last year. This year, an attempt to get Mercedes-Benz interested in a 190 model?
Yes, we did look at it. It was mooted earlier in the year that little new car that Mercedes had with the 2.3 Cosworth-headed engine.
Which, incidentally, I'm sorry to interrupt, but is now 2.5 litre at the Frankfurt Motor Show.
Yes, that will augur well for its chances in the future.
Grice in problems. We'll come back to your future plans, Alan, but Grice, car number 6, 23rd place, 67 laps completed, limping round towards the pits. And we'll come back to you in just a moment, Alan Moffat, to talk about what might be in the future for you in Group A racing.
Well, rock-a-arm fever has struck Sandown this afternoon because not only are the Holdens copping it, also Kevin Bartlett in the Mitsubishi. What went wrong?
Yeah, for a very strange reason, an exhaust rocker broke. We've never had a failure with that part of the engine at all. As a matter of fact, that was going to be the least of our worries. It took us a while to find it because of that. When you have an area in an engine that is a little bit weak, obviously you think, right, I will look at it. But we've got no weak area in the engine itself. The only thing we'd expect that we'd do in the engine would be maybe a turbocharger, because most turbo cars give turbocharger trouble. But no, the turbo's fine. It broke a rocker, broke an exhaust rocker. And the amount of pressure, when the exhaust rocker was broken, the amount of pressure in the cylinder broke the inlet rocker as well.
So is it a one-off problem, Kevin? Or
yes, it's definitely a one-off problem, because when we did change it, and in fact being an overhead cam car, you have to pull all of the rocker gear off, the whole lot. Not like a Chevy V8 or a Holden or a Ford V8 where you pull a tappet cover off and change one rocker and screw it back on. No, you've got to pull the whole gear off, put it back on, retime the engine, time the cam belt. Quite an involved job. And since then, the car has run marvellously. We've done 80 laps, flat out. The car is doing the times that the leaders are doing. Doing 55s, 55.5, 55.4. I had done enough laps that I could bring it in and put Peter McKay in, who hasn't had a fair go in the car. Peter's in the car now. His times have come down something like 3 seconds in the last 15 laps, and he's now only within about 2.5 seconds of my times.
And you've been watching him like a hawk, Kevin. This is a learning process for him?
It is a learning process for Peter, yeah. He has to get the confidence in the car that I have. I've got great confidence in its brakes, its handling, the gearbox, the engine. The whole package is very, very good. We've been testing some new tyres while we've been out there, and they've turned out very good. Very, very good indeed. And we're very happy. We've had the problem, but by the same token, the car is as good now as it was on the third or fourth lap.
Kevin, there's still the suggestion that a good little car will never beat a good big car at Bathurst.
Well, the tables are being turned here today, because you'll see that the Toyota of Peter Williamson's, the Alfa Romeo of Colin Bond's, our car, as far as times are concerned, in the under 3 litre class, are up in the top five. Outright.
There goes the Alan Grice car finally being wheeled away. And another suggestion that maybe a good little car will come good.
Well, that's another Holden bit the dust. Woo! Yeah, I think at Bathurst you'll find that maybe the under 3 litre cars, which aren't all that far away on lap times, will be there at the end of the day. I'm certain that the problem we've got is an isolated one. Obviously, we'll go to great lengths to make sure that it is only an isolated one. There'll be a lot of crack testing, a lot of x-raying, and a lot of engine movement being done between now and Bathurst anyway.
Well, there's an interesting prospect from Kevin Bartlett, but really, can a 3 litre car do a 5 litre car? Alan Moffat?
I don't think so, John. But naturally, you've got to work on the premise that as long as a V8 is a sick V8, it's certainly going to be no match for a good 3 litre. Bathurst always responds to the power, the torque up through BP cutting, where the engines are always in second gear. Could rephrase that and say the transmissions are always in second gear, the engines are at their maximum torque loading. A V8 just rockets up that hill, and then of course has the advantage of the big capacity engine, which also rockets it down the mountain.
But there's always stopping. It must be a change for Kevin Bartlett to go to Bathurst confident in a car that's got some brakes.
Well, compared to his very heavy Camaro, that was much more bravery required there than normally...
He had brakes, he just had to borrow them from other people.
Yes, okay. No, I think Bathurst is always going to be an area where a very good horsepower car is going to be hard to beat. And in that respect, the V12 capacity of the Jaguars are going to be a very serious threat.
They'll be doing, I think, in excess of 260 kilometres an hour down the straight. It'll be fairly lively. But to go back to you, Allan, you were, as I say, talking to Mercedes-Benz about the homologation of their Cosworth engine 2.3 190 model car. That's no longer in the offing?
At the time that we initially spoke, Will, they weren't certain whether they were going to homologate. And it was one of these exercises that takes place in the boardroom, and one minute it is and one minute it was. And at the last minute, it was homologated. The car's proven in Group A competition with that, exactly what John Smales is alluding to. A small engine car, non-turbocharged, doesn't have a chance against a big capacity V8.
Bob Holden, car 57. The Toyota Sprinter leading Group C, and they're all saying, when's he going to retire? Why should he?
Exactly. The man who, with the number, the dreaded number 13, won at Bathurst with Rano Altonen, and I'm doing a bit of name-dropping today, but I ran into Rano Altonen at the Frankfurt Motor Show, where he was involved with BMW.
And place-dropping, too.
Giving...
Monza?
Giving... demonstrations to the crowd, and talking about BMW's new four-wheel drive 325 model. And Bob Holden, as I say, won at Bathurst in 1966 and had been racing for a long time then.
This is the fragment of the crown wheel and pinion that's cost Robbie Francevic the race. Mark Bench, most disappointing.
Yes, very disappointing, because the Volvo crown wheel and pinion is immensely strong, and this appears to be a manufacturing defect. Certainly we've never seen anything like it before. It's just a segment, part of the tooth from the crown wheel has just actually flawed and broken out and then been caught up with the pinion, and that of course seized the crown wheel and pinion, and they brought the car to a rather quick halt.
Well, Mark, that's bad news for you, but I guess it's good news for John Bell, who I think was thinking that maybe he was somewhat contributory.
Well, John was doing a very good job out there, and we're certainly very happy with his involvement with the team, and we'd like John to be somehow in the act next year, where I want to run two cars, and certainly this is a most unusual occurrence for a Volvo, and I don't think we'll see it be repeated.
The bad news we heard was that the Eckenberger Volvo team is not coming to Bathurst this year. How does that leave you in terms of all the quick bits that you were expecting?
I've got to say, a little bit nervous. I have a phone call to Sweden to make tomorrow night, and I guess on Tuesday I'll know exactly what I'm getting and what I'm not. But even so, I think the parts that are already en route to us will see us a little more competitive about this.
Those parts include the new works motor?
Yes, we already actually have that, but we don't have the management electronic system that goes with it. But I can't see how we won't get that. But the motor is actually in the truck right now.
How do you keep Robbie Francevic so aggressive as he is this year, and how do you keep him that way for the next 3 weeks?
Oh, that's just in Robbie's nature, you know. He's always been like that, and I guess we've been friends for so many years, I just give him a rev up occasionally.
Well, I tell you what, he hopped out of the car at that first pit stop when he was running out of fuel, and I thought he was going to deck you.
Yeah, well, of course, you know, it's been like that over the years, but we really are the best of friends.
Mark, you were entered in the car for today's race. Is it possible that you will get to Bathurst in a drive situation?
I think realistically there's other guys that'll do a better job than me, and I might just wait until, as much as I'd love to run Bathurst, I haven't done the miles, and I think I'll wait until I get home for the Benson and Hedges series.
Mark Patch, thank you, and thank you also for your participation in Australian motorsport this year.
Thank you.
That must have been a pretty good piece of driving from John Bow to... get in someone's road when she locked up.
Yes, although I don't know how quickly he was going at the time, but you don't take long to pull up either, because the car's in an unstable situation when it locks the rears, because when the wheels are locked, they are in fact have less adhesion than if they're pulling up, and so the back end's gaining on the front, although that's only the situation if you've got the brakes on, I suppose rolling free, it would be drag on the rear rather than the front. But anyway...
Nasty feeling.
Yes, and certainly one that probably gave him a bit of a sinking feeling in terms of, have I done something wrong? But John Bow is a guy that was offered a drive by the Holden dealer team. And look on the straight. There's the leading car, number 31. And the second one down there... Now, Cameron now is the one that's chasing it. It's Longhurst. He's 10.6 seconds in arrears. They've completed 109 laps. They have 20 remaining, and there's only 10.6 seconds that this man wants. Tony Longhurst, lean and hungry, determined, former Australian water ski champion.
Hungry enough to try and snatch the lead, though. Oh, that's what's going to be answered shortly.
Yes, well, we're going to get an answer to that, whether they're going to be happy to circulate in company, or whether Longhurst will blast past Crichton into the lead and dispatch him rather rudely. But that, as I say, will be answered, in, I'd reckon, within four laps' time.
Any two-car teams will... It's very rare that you can have two identical cars. There are always a set of circumstances arise where there's sometimes not always enough parts to go around, and naturally the second car is not always the fastest car on the track. In this case, we have the situation where we'll assume that Jim Richards had the best car, and it's in the second spot, so it perhaps has the get up and go to buy a car 31 if it has to. But I don't think they're going to be silly enough to race each other.
Usually the development goes into the lead car.
Exactly.
As often the Holden dealer team cars are slightly different. They ran different brake calipers at Oran Park, for instance. The engine development probably goes into Brock's car and then later is introduced to Harvey's car. They've actually run three cars this year. Harvey today was driving Brock's car that was debuted at Calder, and the what was originally been Brock's car was retired to become the slave car or the test car for Bathurst, and Brock was debuting a brand new car. Let's have a look at the straight situation again and see if we see creeping into picture the BMW. There it is. It's not so much creeping as looming up, 6.94 seconds behind only, and they've completed 110. They're three laps in front of, in third place, still the Alfa Romeo, Colin Bond and Greg Hansen. What a fine, superb job they've done. They really have. 2.5 litre V6 Alfa, 3.5 litre BMWs. Not to be dismissed lightly either. That's a great effort against 5 litre opposition.
There's the question, of course, about the championship. Two rounds won by Richards. And he'd be looking to get maximum points from this one as well to add to his Australian Touring Car Championship crown.
Indeed. And the man, of course, who's defending, well, not defending, but who is the holder of the Drivers' Championship, sitting on your left, Peter G., Alan Moffat. And it was the cars that he and Greg Hansford drove, Greg Hansford now sharing the 47, number 47 Alpha with Colin Bond, that took Mazda to the Manufacturers' Championship last year. 110 points, Alan, to 108, so close, for General Motors.
Yes, we went right down to the last race on that one. I think we're seeing here again the number one car, the car number one, and it is the leading car in the BMW team. With nothing to lose but going for broke, they will gain a lot of knowledge from this car tomorrow morning, or hopefully maybe not tomorrow morning, but at least by Tuesday morning. And we'll have had the benefit of bringing home two cars, which is always nice, gives you a nice warm feeling on your left, under your left rib cage, going into Bathurst, knowing that you have done it. It's no fluke to get one car to this checkered flag. Getting two cars is a tremendous credit to the whole team, and they'll have had the benefit of having seen the number one car come from behind the field, as it did with Jim's problem earlier in the race, to come up and have a very strong finish in second spot.
5.4 seconds the gap now between first and second, and well, three laps the gap back to this one in third place.
If you think we're discussing the situation, I can assure you that Ron Meacham, the managing director of BMW, and Frank Gardner have got each some very clammy hands at the moment, just hoping that their drivers aren't going to do anything silly and jeopardize this great finish.
Yes, well, you mentioned Ron Meacham, and while we're looking at the Alfa in third place, I think it's worth saying that
it takes a lot of understanding in motor industry management to fall on your tail and to get egg on your face in motor racing. And BMW, let's be honest about it, did it for some while, but Ron Meacham had great faith in the product, in his team manager Frank Gardner, and ultimately in Group A regulations. And if it were not for the decision and the backing of that man in the chair at BMW, this would not be happening.
Yes, well, that's absolutely true, Will, and you'd be surprised at just how uneducated a lot of management are in this area. They're quite easy to take the laurels when they're going, and just so easy and quick to jump out when there's the slightest little bit of problem. And in that respect, I endorse your comments totally.
It's understanding that isn't always easy to financial and to management people, and they don't sometimes see the profit in being out in front of the public and being embarrassed. But look at the benefits they're reaping now. Fantastic as they come round onto the pit straight again.
I think it can equally be said, Will, that the comments you've just mentioned are equally true to the sponsors, who, when their team is in a losing period, and that's the only thing, even being kind, we can say that the JPS team had a number of years of being in a losing situation.
Yes, it's fair.
But the John Player Cigarette Company stayed with them, and today they've got two of their beautiful cars promoting their products for them.
Yes, well, there were two other cigarette companies that dominated them for some while. You were running one of them, but it's a great effort, and what we're saying is results justly but hard-earned. And as they go up the back straight now, Longhurst really does have the whiff, and he starts to close and go deeply under brakes as he pursues Neville Crichton. Crichton in 31, the car that George Fury was driving when it hit the lead. Longhurst in the car that Jim Richards drove in the opening stint of the race, but which, as we saw, had that problem on lap 10, stopped, was cured by Jim Richards, the 1985 Australian Touring Car Champion, and which has done this absolutely remarkable recovery. Quite amazing, because they went down to 28th place on lap 9. It was lap 9 that it stopped, and they were 28th. They were 25th on lap 10, 24th on lap 12. 21st, lap 15. They'd got up to 14th by lap 28, and it's taken them all this time now to be threatening for the lead. It's been a long, planned, patient process. Fifth place, lap 49. By half race distance, they were back up to second. They were second at lap 61, and for the next laps up to 112, it's taken them till now to get up and to argue with their fellow team car.
I think Neville Crichton's got a bit of a squirt along there, though.
1.1 seconds.
Well, I doubt very much whether he's just going to move over and let him drive by, but by the same token, I'm not so sure that... I don't know, he's coming up with quite a degree of verve, and it does look as if he's got... the idea that he wants to take over the number one position.
The car, the person this will most pain among those four drivers, I suspect, Allan, is George Fury.
Yes.
Standing there in the pits. George knows. There's Fury, and there's Richards, and I think we saw what
We saw what he was thinking.
Yeah. But good stuff, and he's a great bloke, George Fury, and so is Jim Richards.
And car one is in number one position now. Tony Longhurst and Jim Richards, BMW, from the Neville Crichton George Fury car. And that's the way they will stay, barring mechanical problems, to the end of this race.
What a great job young Tony Longhurst has done. We've seen him in the 323 BMW, whittling away. He drove a really nuggety race at Amaru Park, battling with Colin Bond, getting past him, and came home sixth there in the 3-2-3. He finally finished behind Bond, but there were problems involved in that. Then at Oran Park, wasn't quite so competitive and came home 10th. But now sharing the big car, the 635, around 300 odd horsepower.
Well, I can only assume that the number one BMW team car is certainly superior to the number 31 car. For that to have happened and now to open up a bit of a gap there, I would say a little bit ungracefully, to such a word. Personally, I've been in this type of situation. I think I would have been quite happy to have driven quietly along with my teammate and given the company maximum benefit of the two cars running together.
Frank Gardner should be decent and throw a bit of drama into the situation and pull both of them in and put the lead drivers
reprimand
back in the
them.
Car. And let's have a race to the flag between Jim Richards and George Shurey.
Yes. I think you're grasping at straws there, Will.
Well, back behind these two, in second place, it's Colin Bond, three laps down on the two BMWs and a minute 23 ahead of Peter Williamson in the Supra.
They've been racing 114 laps, the two BMWs. They have been racing for 3 hours, 44 minutes in about 6 seconds time. And can't quite say it was fault-free, but very close to it, certainly in a mechanical sense.
So a form finish for the BMWs. You can see that famous board hanging out the side. They'd be wired up for sound, these cars.
Yes, now Crichton's tucking in. Longhurst, I think, made his point, and I think we're getting into some sort of formation, which Allan requires great concentration driving that close together for the next 15 laps. And does it introduce some possibility of not enough cool air getting into the second car?
They're not really quite that close at this distance, Will, but certainly if you were trying to do the bumper part of bumper stunts that Pete Gagan and I used to do in HO Falcons, the temperature gauge can go up pretty quickly. But on the long straights here at Sandown, it's only necessary to pull out a little bit, a quarter of a car's width, and enough air does go in.
Wilkinson and Balcott. Car number 39 in fifth place, 110 laps completed, five down on the leader, and bogged.
Well, the sand isn't the only thing that will trap cars here at Sandown.
Well, with the slick construction of the tyres, Peter, so they get on that, and it's just like being on a skating rink. They can't get any traction. Perhaps with a little assistance, they may be able to coax it out. But he's a fair way in, and also on a gradient there that isn't making it easy. Yep, they'll push it backwards.
See the line it took as it spun around. And the car that they have to worry about is 36, Graham and Ken Lusty. But they are one lap down. They've completed just 109.
Looks like he's headed down the escape road there to get way off the circuit like that. He's back on it now, and a wave to the assistants. And behind the two black cars. Still in fifth position, though, that Balcott Wilkinson car. It's Tony Longhurst leads the Castrol 500. In their 115th lap, so 14 to go in this race. Behind him is Neville Crichton.
It's awfully nice with the tremendous effort that goes into maintaining a two-car team. The easiest thing in the world to adopt is a single-car team. Maximum effort on one vehicle, a surplus of staff to cater to every need. Two-car teams are such cause a great deal extra work on the mechanics. There isn't a team in Australia that has, in effect, two one-car teams. They're always generally just staffed by about one and a half people to manage the two cars, unlike the Formula One Brigade, which go to the circuit, Will, with 22 to 24 people in the pit lane.
In the pit lane.
As you've seen, it's an unbelievable exercise. But every team in Australia stretches their manpower resources to the limit. And it's great for any team to be able to have a 1-2 in a relatively cozy situation that we're witnessing here today. It gives the mechanics from the number two team a chance to say, yeah, well, we did it too.
Have so many people in a Formula One team. When Alan Jones was in the Williams team, they had 65 employees to race two cars. and they are now closer to 100, and Ferrari is closer to 200 in its team. Of course, Ferrari do a lot of its own design,
and the
gearboxes
engines.
And yep. engines, but it is quite phenomenal. And then when you see a team like the Brabham BMW, who boost their qualifying motor up to this more than 5 atmospheres, and they are writing off an engine that is perhaps $80,000 or $100,000, and they're really going to saying, we're prepared to dispense with the entire engine for 2 laps.
And is that why a team like Renault decides to opt out?
Renault's in a situation where, as a company, it's not making money. It's very embarrassed because the actual Renault Formula One cars are doing less well than the Renault engined cars like the Lotuses, and that's a bit embarrassing. And they've decided they can get quite a deal of useful technical development and exposure while by supplying engines which might even make them a few francs instead of at the moment spending lots.
Looking at Group C for a moment, back to the leaders now. 5 laps to go. 12 laps to go. Not giving you a heart attack. Well, sorry about it if I did. But I don't think anyone's getting too many heart attacks out there. It seems a very peaceful spring, early summer afternoon.
Best sun we've had all day. Very golden at the moment. And if you're out in the open air, I think the sun would be a little bit warming, which is more than it's been most of the day.
Some people may be wondering why the BMWs have different wheels on the front to the back. They're not actually different wheels, but they're running the brake fins on the front. They're plastic additions that go on a bit like a hubcap. And only when the wheel's stationary can you see the fan effect that draws the air through the brake disc and gives the front of the car extra cooling. They don't need them on the back. Obviously, the brake bias between the front and the rear is such that only the fronts are getting super hot. The engine on a BMW sits quite far forward in the chassis, and as such, a lot of weight transfer takes place under brakes, and it's only the fronts that are requiring that extra cooling. But on some of the bigger cars in years past, we've seen the fins on the front and the rear.
Those discs do get hot too. I remember going out to a night meeting at Cooler, and it was a new thing to see the red glow as they come up to a braking section of the track.
Well, they're not actually working unless they are red hot. If they don't glow, they haven't reached their optimum temperature. Of course, if they stay red for too long, they also go past their optimum temperature.
Not only do the discs glow red, so do the turbochargers, and for that matter, so do exhaust manifolds. I can remember seeing a perfectly standard road-going engine being dynamometer tested at Leyland years ago, and it was going between maximum torque and maximum power, doing a minute at each, and within 10 or so seconds of going on to 5,500 revs, the whole exhaust manifold was glowing red. People don't realise, with the insulation, the refinement in modern motor cars, just what's going on under the bonnet. There's things thrashing around there, the most incredible rate being kept together. It's like a cement mixer, potentially.
Right. Well,
very high-speed one.
They never had any heaters on Model Ts, Will. They didn't need them. The floorboards could catch fire
easily. And they were, of course, had very modest power outputs as well.
Exactly. I can assure you the driver in these cars are feeling that heat today.
Longhurst doing a fine job, a bit like Thomas Mazira, Tony Longhurst. The same lean, lanky, hungry look about him, to my way of thinking. Very lean in the face, very fit. Slim build, very fit. And
drivers that don't take advantage of the opportunities that are in front of them driving for great teams certainly have a lot more going for them than anyone that I know of a decade ago, and they would be absolutely mad not to be at the top of their personal performance and doing everything that was expected of them on and off the track.
Interesting, Allan, the physical efforts involved in motor racing. Just the tension of the sort of what you're doing produces a lot of effort, a lot of very deep breathing. I was watching Allan Jones last weekend,
And he's just got into a car, and he was absolutely almost hyperventilating in the way that he was breathing. I've seen Neal Allan doing that at Warwick Farm and so on. But then there's the business of power steering. Peter Jansen today in the Jaguar was the first power-steered car he raced, whereas Peter Brock and Dick Johnson have been running power-steered cars for a long while. At Macau last year, the BMW people, because of the tight Macau circuit, were suddenly putting power steering on their cars for that particular race. But well, the efforts are very high.
Macau certainly is one of the most difficult circuits in the world, 4 miles around in total distance and bouncing off one wall to another. It's a very tight, demanding circuit.
The thing with power steering, of course, as we look at car 53, one of the Ford Capris, John Craft and Les Gross, cars which won't be running at Bathurst, 3-litre V6, with obviously some problems. The thing with power steering is that the American concept was to make it as light and as vague and wafty as possible. But power steering these days, and the European and Australian concept of it, is delightful. It's got good on-centre feel, lets you know plenty about what the car's doing, and is very direct because it's fairly high geared.
Yes, exactly. Well, like all the refinements that are coming into the cars today, well, one of the things that I think is contributing to some of the accidents we're having on the highways is the fact that an inexperienced person can think they can drive so easily because the car is driving for them. There are so many advantages in a car today, and they get carried away and mix up their ambitions with their abilities too easily. The old-fashioned cars that wobbled and shook and rattled and whatnot maybe kept you a little bit more aware that you were doing 100K and as such should take a little bit more care of where you're going.
Indeed, and what a glorious sight it is of Sandown track from the air. There you see the corner that leads them into the pit straight, the turn-off into the pit lane, which is a magnificent service complex, the best at any Australian motor racing circuit. The paddock behind, the transporters that can be brought right up to the workshop, the cars taken straight in as is required for world championships championship events, endurance sports car racing or Formula One Grand Prix racing. Then the front straight, which is now shorter, coming off earlier into also a tighter corner than was the original Repco corner. Then it has a shorter run. This side of what used to be the pit area goes through an S-bend and then to the back section of the circuit, which is the same as on the previous circuit. The same kink there in the back straight, the same run up the back straight, which must, Allan Moffat, have been very exhilarating, particularly when you continued past now where it turns left.
Yes, well, that was always 120, 130 plus, right about where the last car is now. And the thought of where you had to brake and just drop it down one gear to go down over Winfield Rise down into the S's was quite nerve-wracking, believe me.
So, as Bathurst 77 was Ford 1-2, Sandown 85 is going to be a BMW 1-2. The leading car, piloted by, this stage, Tony Longhurst. Jim Richards, we saw him earlier, a delighted man in the pits. He and George Fury, the number one drivers, content to watch their deputies handle things very neatly out there on the circuit. 31. Being driven at this moment by Neville Crichton. Just a little bit back now from Tony Longhurst.
Well, this is a team that can definitely go to Bathurst now, knowing that they are not to be treated lightly, no matter what takes place in Hardy's Heroes and all the fast lappers that take place on qualifying at Bathurst. Here's a team that has the goods on the board. They've done it, 1-2, no accidents, no luck. And there will be some very worried Holden boys watching
Indeed.
This little act.
The bright pink car going to the pits there, I think, was Barry Jones, who was the man who ran into trouble with his Commodore. There it is. The man that owns the engine in that car is Peter Brock and the mobile Holden dealer team.
Probably wishes he had it back right now. Maybe.
Borrowed some of his old paint too.
Yes, Brock very willingly took a car back to the workshop, pulled the engine of that car out on Friday, gave it to Barry Jones, has not discussed how much it will cost them, and then this morning when they had to put a new engine into John Harvey's car, Harvey was fairly worried because he suddenly realised the only spare beyond what he just put in the car was in that car there.
Yes.
20th was the Jones car before coming in. We're back on the leaders.
Colin Bond, incidentally, is now just two laps behind the leader in that Alfa Romeo, number 47. There he is.
Greg Hansford at the wheel.
And what a great job that car has done, really has done. The two drivers in it, 119 laps completed, 121 by the two BMWs. So it's Germany 1 and 2, Italy 3rd, Japan 4th, and Australia 5th. At the moment, in terms of where the cars come from. Yes. Yeah.
Thank heavens there's no English car in there, Allan, to add to our...
No, they're coming, unfortunately.
Yes, that's right, Bathurst. And the way Peter Brock was talking, he sees it as a Jag benefit, but perhaps from the performance of the BMWs today, he might change his opinion. So at 122 laps down for the leader. There's seven remaining in the race for those two. They get very easily coming up to the concluding stages of this race. And there's a car that did it easily. Well, I was back before my time. One of these chaps can tell us there on Lake Eyre that Donald Campbell broke the land
You'll have
speed
to take
record
this,
in
Will.
The Bluebird.
I was going to Sydney Tech at the time, and I can remember reading the afternoon papers to find out what Campbell was up to. And of course it was in Australia that in that car he set a world land speed record and then set a world speed record in the same year. And of course it was in the Bluebird boat car, I suppose you'd call it a boat,
Coniston Water in England,
that he lost his life. But this was just a glorious thing, a Bristol Proteus turbine engine in the car. I can't get into that car. I've opened the bubble and tried, but the driver sits way down in it and has to slide down into the sort of tube of the car, and of course is sitting right up towards the front of it. Donald Campbell, I think, was living very much in the image of his father Malcolm Campbell, and I think was almost destined ultimately to kill himself chasing that sort of glory. And a wonderful piece of unique British engineering. They have been racing now, Peter G, for just a few seconds over 4 hours, and are just about to complete 123 laps, and that means they will have averaged 119.925 kilometres an hour.
How's that compared to last year, the old Group C?
Peter, don't ask questions like that. I'll tell you. The result last year, Peter Brock and Larry Perkins, from Alan Moffat, Greg Hansford, was a race time of just a few seconds more than we have now. It was 4 hours, no minutes, 27.6 seconds, and that we're just about 15 seconds past that. So last year they'd done
another six laps
in the same time. So an interesting comparison, in fact. Thank you for asking the question.
You did it very well. There's the second place car. In between first and second is the third place car of Greg Hansford and Colin Bond. And that car just in front, the red one, car 39, in fifth place, is the Bowcutt Wilkinson Commodore. It's been off the track a few times in the concluding stages of the race, but has kept fifth place. And in fourth place in front of it is the Peter Williamson Supra.
What a disaster this year. By comparison, last year, the Holden dealer team taking 1-3, this year coming nowhere. Murray Carter was fourth. Oh, and there's the continuing problems for the Kraft Gross Capri. But Carter was fourth. We've told you of the car that he's planning for later this year. Jim Keogh, who was looking after our camera earlier today, was fifth. Peter Williamson, Michael Quinn in the Supra came in sixth, and they're presently lying in fourth place behind the Alpha, so they've come forward two spots. An interesting car that we were hopeful of seeing at this meeting, but which didn't come about, was for Rusty French, a Ford Sierra four-wheel drive turbo 2 litre with Klaus Niedewitz, a German, in the car. What hasn't been mentioned in Australia is that Klaus Niedewitz is a keen motorcycle rider, road bikes, and he took his own road bike to Nürburgring a little while ago, a dreadfully difficult circuit to learn and which is open to the public to go speeding around, fell off his bike and broke his legs. And so has no show of being at Bathurst, nor nor was he a chance of getting here to Sandown. As far as I know, Rusty French has not got that car underway, but it'll be a most interesting car if he can manage to get it here sometime.
Dan Gurney was a great motorbike fan, Will, and Goodyear had to have in the contract that he wasn't permitted to fool around on these motorbikes while he was doing Grand Prix racing.
Jim Richards has about five bikes, I think.
Well, they're very great works of art. They're fabulous to look at, and you're an aficionado on them. I don't claim to be a two-wheel driver, but I can understand they're exhilarating.
Did Allan Jones come off his farm bike as well?
Yes, indeed. Allan Jones is another one. They've got a motorcycle dealership.
He hit a low-flying heifer or something, didn't he? I'm not sure what happened there.
So, that's the situation. Five laps to go, and BMW 1-2, Alfa Romeo 3rd. Are they going to tighten it up and go across the line together at the finish?
Well, we were talking earlier of physical effort, Allan, both in the concentration and the mental aspect of motor racing, but also around Sandown, particularly in the physical side of it here. And Tony Longhurst and Crichton are doing a great job. They've been in the cars a long time, and they've got, in a sense, the mental challenge of the race is over. And now is the chance of possibly making an error.
Very easily.
Very relaxed. We've done it. We're where we want to be. Everything's under control. Bang. You're off in the grass.
Well, they've acquitted themselves very well there, and I'm sure Frank Gardner will be very pleased with his co-drivers, which is more than the other teams, I won't say can say, but at least the other teams today, their co-drivers didn't get very much time behind the wheel, and as such will be doing maybe more laps than they want to. In practice, it matters.
Allan Moffat, we were on a subject with you earlier which we didn't complete, which was Group A racing.
I thought you were going to forget about
that. And your racing future.
Mm-hmm.
What about a team for next year?
Oh, well, we're working on one, and hopefully we will be back. I prefer not to comment on the vehicles involved, but I'm very happy to say that we're negotiating with a very fine company.
I'm not going to be diplomatic.
Get the resources necessary to do this.
You're working for us today. Does it come from Europe or Japan?
Is that part of the world?
He said he was going to be nice to the media.
Now listen, Will,
didn't he?
We're colleagues today. I don't have to be nice to this. I'm not going to answer back.
All right. I've got an Allan Moffat answer.
I'm happy to say, and for all the fans that have been writing me throughout the year inquiring, and we are looking forward to being back in business. I've still got my great team. We're working together, and we're really just looking for a job ahead of us.
Is that definite, that you will be back next year?
It's not definite at this stage, but I'm hopeful that we'll be able to announce something within 6 weeks.
One or two car team?
What was the question?
One or two car team?
I've got my headset on here, man. It's awfully tight, these cans. I don't think you're going to get
anything more out of him. Will, coming down to see three laps remaining in the Castrol 500 for 1985, and there it is, Tony Longhurst, Jim Richards, number one. Dick Johnson, the foreground still circulating, and there in the background, the Fury Crichton BMW.
We reckoned last year that the Holden dealer team had done a great job coming home 1-3, one of the cars, a new car. These admittedly are proven cars, but it's just a perfect result, isn't it, to come home 1-2 in a race of this distance. It's only 2 years it's been run to the 500-kilometre length, not 400, and it is now a very arduous race with, as John Smales was saying earlier, more gear changing, more braking, more driver effort per lap than at Bathurst.
And that's a very significant fact that has been overlooked by a lot of people. They said, well, what's the difference between 400 and 500 kilometres, only 100 kilometres. It's a big jump. A big
and
jump up.
A bit of drama right near the end. It looks as though Tony Longhurst will go away with 31, a long way behind him, because it looks as though we're going to see the second BMW, Neville Crichton, come into the pits for a bit of fuel. John Smales is down there ready.
Well, that can only be a case of having pushed it beyond its need to catch car 31 in the first place, and quite honestly, with three laps to go, that's...
Well, I think it's going to be the 31 actually that will come in, Allan.
And let's hear from John Smales. John, do you know what's happening down there?
Yes, I do know what's happening at the moment, Will. They're setting up for Neville Crichton to come in for a fuel stop. They've also got three wheels out just as a security measure. Now, I'm gathering, and Frank Gardner's a little bit closed-mouthed about it, which is unusual, that they're just going to simply do a test on Crichton and see how he goes. If they feel the need to, they'll then bring in the lead car. But at the moment, it's Crichton only.
So, testing the depth of the fuel tank.
Well, this doesn't add up, Will. They went past the halfway mark on the hardest half of the race, the second half by nature of more rubber on the track and just the length of the race. The second half is always the easiest half. That's impossible for the vehicle to be out of fuel. This would be crafty old Frank having another quick pit stop just to keep his team on the ball.
Yes. The interesting fact these days is with the dry brake fueling systems that we have, absolutely no spillage. You can't get the fuel going into the car unless, as Crichton goes on down the straight, you can't get the fuel into the car unless it's pointed into the fuel tank so that they don't have to switch the engines off. So you have none of that drama that used to be the case of and wondering whether the thing would restart.
Exactly, and also with the vent bottles, people that see two cans go on, that's not two cans of fuel going in. The one is a breather bottle. And as such, when the tank is full, the fuel goes into the breather bottle. They know they've got a chock-a-block tank. So that's when really the pit stop is over. The tire changers always beat the fuelers.
Well, is Frank Gardner throwing us a red herring? Past goes Crichton. Two laps to go. Well, one and a half now. That's the leader, Tony Longhurst.
On his 128th lap.
They could be being cautious. They could be being cautious.
Frank Gardner, what's happening?
We've had a signal from Neville Crichton that seems as though all is not well, but I don't know. His lap times are about right, but he signaled as though he's coming in, so we're just standing by with tyres and fuel. Two laps to go.
You're looking right, because you got to 70 laps before.
We still had plenty of fuel in it, but he might have got a bit of dirt in the system, or you don't know, so you've just got to be ready.
Any suggestion that you would bring in the lead car as well?
No. No suggestion at all.
Car. Will it come in this time? If it was a block, it may have freed itself and Crichton will stay out there.
A great win for Castrol here today, Will. Not only sponsors the race, but having the BMW team bringing their oils home.
So coming onto the top of the main straight is Neville Crichton. And the last lap board is out for Tony Longhurst.
Dick Johnson leading him at this stage, but Dick Johnson's back in 21st position, has completed 91 laps, and very appropriately the music comes up.
The ABC victory theme for the JPS BMW.
And it's a theme and a feeling with which they've been very familiar this year. Great effort by the JPS BMW team led by Frank Gardner, but by both Jim Richards, who drove the car in the opening stint, and I think perhaps even more so by his young protege Tony Longhurst, who's driven it so well, pulled back an enormous deficit, come back from 28th position on lap 9. That was just quite incredible. Fixed a problem out in the field and then hit the lead on lap number 114 with 15 laps remaining, and has led from there and built up a handy lead.
I think having the nous to know how to fix a problem, Will, was credit to Jim. There's not all that many drivers that can actually diagnose the problem in the first place, but he did, and he did it right, and he got back out there and showed us how to do it.
Well, it'll be a delight at Tony Longhurst, because this is his first major win in a touring car race. He's been out there for less than half the race, but not very much less. The race is now 4 hours, 10 minutes and, nearly 12 minutes old. Last year's, where it ran just 4 hours and 27 seconds. And with his teammate in car 31 in second place, it's a delighted Tony Longhurst heading towards the finishing line. Second place will be Neville Crichton and George Fury.
onto the straight. No more corners, no more obstacles, can roll to the finish. 129 laps coming up, three ahead of the Alfa Romeo GT V6 in third place. And a victory for Tony Longhurst, driving at the moment in car number one and into second place. Just a few seconds behind, about 5 seconds behind, goes the Kiwi driver Neville Crichton in car number 31, both of them BMW 635s. In the pits, Ron Meacham, managing director of BMW Australia, congratulating the team manager, Frank Gardner, in whom he's had so much faith, and Longhurst, the young man that's done absolutely everything asked of him today. Neville Crichton, the much older New Zealand businessman beside him, supported so well by the Nissan team driver, George Fury, on loan to BMW. Drove on their merits, no team orders, and came home in that position. One to car one, two to car 31. A great effort of preparation, testing, sorting, and ultimately driving at Sandown in the Castrol 500, over 503 kilometres, 129 laps.
They must go to Bathurst as strong favourites, Will.
Well, that sort of reliability certainly puts them in a strong seat, but of course they will be trailing on speed to other cars, and certainly the V12 Jaguars. There they are, the winners. Not forgetting that in third place was car number 47, the Alfa Romeo GT V6 driven by Colin Bond and Greg Hansford. They finished on 127 laps completed. And suddenly, weary arms and tired brains. Certainly the arms become very flexible. Very easy to wave them at this stage, Alan Moffat.
Quite soggy, actually, Will.
Imagine a delightful feeling to motor round to the applause of the flag marshals, ultimately of your team, and then the crowd. Which is where they're heading now, to the main grandstand at Sandown, in what has been a quite dominant effort by the two cars, and one that's really given the other teams in Australian touring car racing a lot to go away and think about prior to the James Hardy 1000 at Bathurst in just 3 weeks' time. And we must mention, surely, in terms of major Australian motorsport, the Castrol 6-hour for motorcycles, which will be 3 weeks after that at Oran Park on October the 27th, and that will be covered by ABC Sport. And then, of course, the greatest moment, I think, in the for Australian motorsport enthusiasts, the Australian Formula One Grand Prix at Adelaide on November the 3rd. But at the moment, it's Longhurst, Tony Longhurst, with Jim Richards, squashed into the right-hand side of the left-hand drive BMW, now down to a grandstand, applauding generously a great effort by the JPS team.
So, Tony Longhurst steps out of his black BMW, number one, and number one for the three rounds of the Australian Endurance Championship, and all importantly, number one here in the Castrol 500, with second place going to Neville Crichton, who piloted the car in the second half of the race, George Fury for the first part, taking the initial lead, and Jim Richards doing that mechanical work to get number one to the line first. We hope you've enjoyed the Castrol 500 for 85. On behalf of the technical and commentary crew, Peter G for ABC Sport.